So for anyone out there who is like, well, I guess President Bush lied to us. You know what? Yeah. He lied to us.
Because you need it.
You need to be lied to because you need a reason. The reason was 9/11.
At this hour, American and coalition forces are in the early stages of military operations to disarm Iraq, to free its people.
It is the greatest thing. And yes, we needed to tell the rest of the world some cockamamie story about weapons of mass destruction. Who cares? I see some of them on TV going, "You Americans, you bombed our houses. Shut up, you pussy."
And you'll see that I will be right about this.
I got to say again, congratulations to President Bush. He just went in and took out Iraq for no reason, really. There's no weapons of mass destruction, and it's great.
Somebody just called and said that on CNN, a second plane just crashed into one of
them. Stop it!
A second plane.
Wait,
two different buildings.
They are two buildings, and that is
on Y2K, that's why I stayed home. Oh, and you should have seen when the fireworks came out. I was having like
panic attacks. You know what? This is our worst nightmare. You knew this was going to happen one day. And it's happened.
Well, it's because we never settle anything.
You know
what?
Right.
I got to tell
you.
And we don't
face the fact that the, you know, and I'm not saying it's the Arabs who did this. I don't know yet, but I'm guessing the Arab world has to be taught a lesson that we are the boss and you are going to be our dogs and you have got to be spanked.
Will you do me a favor, please?
Yeah.
Not be the leader of these thoughts right now.
Yeah, it's true. And I'm not being the leader of the thoughts. I'm saying I don't know who did it yet. It could have even been one of our own people.
It could have been the Peru guy. It could have been like the Oklahoma guy. It could have been like one of our own people.
It could have been one of our own people. But you want to know something?
It doesn't look like it. I don't want you to be scared now, right?
Yeah. If we don't make good and really, and I mean, maybe I'm not being crazy here. Take five of these countries, Syria, I don't care who
United
did
Arab
it.
United Arab Emirates.
Because they're talking about going after the people who did this and they have to figure out who did it. Who cares? Let me tell you what happened in our country's history, if I may.
Right.
Remember the Olympics where the Israelis were there and the...
72.
That's right. The Arabs slaughtered the Israeli Olympians. Mm-hmm. The response that we had was sickening. We let the Olympics go on.
Yep. Well,
and we did nothing.
Yeah, and the same thing with the last bombing at a trade center. Something drastic should have happened then.
When the Olympics were taken over by these terrorists, that was the time to go over and bomb the living crap out of every country that's ever harbored terrorists. Period.
Because by not doing that, this exact thing happened yesterday.
Yeah, and if we're going to sit and wait for world reaction, and let me tell you something. We need the rest of the world to come in on this with us, this massive bombing we now have to do. And I think we should actually level six countries. I'll name them if you want. Level them to the point where no people live. A cockroach can't even survive. Like Hiroshima.
Exactly.
The Japanese learned their lesson in Hiroshima. As horrible as Hiroshima was, that war would have continued. Harry Truman said, I'm putting a stop to this, and I'm setting up an example for the rest of the world. We have nuclear weapons, and we're not afraid to use them. I'm just wondering what our military response is going to be.
What'd you think about, you know, Bush's speech?
Well, Bush said the one sentence I wanted to hear. I mean, I the one sentence was, we will not, you know, we will go after the countries that harbor terrorists. Yeah. And that's, the countries have to be
that
wiped
was the
out.
Best,
it will happen.
We will not differentiate between the terrorists and the countries who harbor.
Well, they're all making,
military minds
even Yasser Arafat is releasing a statement saying, oh, we don't approve of this. Meanwhile, they're parading in the streets. We got to wipe out every man, woman, and child who thinks it's a good idea to blow themselves up.
That's right. Those people
we'll
who are dancing, they should be blown up.
Yeah, we should blow them up today.
Well, isn't Bin Laden?
Wait.
I saw a picture of a kid. They're showing the Palestinians who're celebrating in the street. And look at this picture of this 8-year-old kid. I'm thinking, and he's got his fingers up like it's victory.
Victory.
You know what?
They think they're watching a movie.
I have a hard time saying this, but kill him now before he kills us later.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's what everyone wants.
They would say, you know,
and you know what? We have every opportunity now to do it. No one can argue with us.
No. Well, even Tony Blair, the Prime Minister of England, said it's not the United States against terrorism; it's the world.
John, you're on the air.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hey, Howard.
Hey.
I'm kind of pissed off, man. You said that you want to bomb countries perhaps responsible?
Yes.
So what does that bring? More death.
Oh, I'll tell you
That's
what it
right.
brings. Yeah. It brings
right.
It brings respect. You know, they did it to Muammar Gaddafi. He keeps his mouth shut now.
Yeah. Didn't he give up
he's
those
He's got
terrors?
No choice.
We did it to, he's got no choice. We did it to Japan. They shut up in World War II. They went, you know, at the end of World War II, when Germany had already surrendered, Japan would not surrender. They were still going to sit and nip away at us, to use a nice word.
Surrender after we dropped the first bomb.
That's right. And
so,
Harry
so you're
Truman.
You're advocating bombing innocent children?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, innocent Americans.
You've got to be kidding me.
Liberal tree huggers. This is one of those liberal tree huggers.
Dude, what are you suggesting we do? What do you
Did
think
you
we should
see
do?
Those children
I don't know, but bombing innocent children.
Of course,
it,
no,
are
they're
those
not
children innocent who were celebrating the streets yesterday? Are they innocent?
But you know what?
You're a sick man.
Have you seen babies?
Even if you think the babies are innocent,
toast them.
They're only
going
to grow up to do this to us again. And there's only one. And listen,
Hitler was 5 years old at one point, too.
Thank you.
Thank you. We could take over him.
The babies are raised.
No, absolutely. I think you're putting me on, right?
Woo! I don't know. I'm curious, dude.
You want to live in a world like this?
Give me a break, guys. Come on now.
What?
I mean, bombing is not the answer.
Oh, what is
What's the answer?
All right, sure.
Sitting
what is
back.
The answer? Why do you listen? If a kid at school kicks your ass every day, a bully, what
right.
do you do?
I don't know. What if he's 2 years old?
No. You didn't answer the question. I'm going to put it in very simple terms for you.
Please do.
A guy, he's 18 years old,
mm-hmm.
and you're 5. And every day he sees you, he takes a brick and whacks you in the head till your head is bloody.
Okay.
What would you do?
I'd run away.
You'd run away.
Good
Coward.
For you.
Well, we can't
right.
pick up the whole West Coast to take it with us.
Yeah,
right.
but what happens when you run out of room to run?
So in other words,
when he's got you cornered, what do you do?
Bomb.
It's a knife. You take it and you stick it in the side of his neck.
Listen, when you've got countries who are harboring terrorists.
Sure.
You either got to make a decision. You're either going to teach them a lesson.
You bomb innocent women and children.
Yes.
Because they're not innocent.
Absolutely.
They're not innocent.
They're not innocent.
You're
a big fat pussy.
F you.
Oh, you want to fight now?
Yeah. F you.
Come on down here. I'll show you how much of a pussy I am.
Yeah.
Oh,
5 years
man.
In the 82nd Airborne.
That's right.
Whacking
jerk
his
offs like you.
Yeah.
F-15s.
Vietnam.
I tell you what. Here's the deal.
Yeah.
Take some old bombs and go bomb who you want to bomb.
How do we bomb you?
We're going to bomb you.
Jackass.
Wish I knew who you were.
Yeah, we'll put you on top.
You've been drinking, right?
Dick, I hung up on him. I can't listen to that guy.
Do these guys have the bomb? An atomic bomb?
They got nothing. Israel has the atomic bomb. Israel has the atomic bomb. And you know what they have? They have chemical. They have chemical warfare. And you know what you do? Flatten them out into a parking lot. There will be no chemicals. There will be nothing.
The chemicals will only go on them.
And we will have all the oil in the world. This will be fantastic for the economy.
But that's why you don't nuke.
But see, you do.
No.
You do because you
know radioactive oil is good.
Yeah. It runs cars.
It runs submarines.
You don't even have to put it in the car. It'll run the car.
And the Pentagon. Whoever thought? I always had learned in school that the Pentagon's airspace, that if anybody flew anywhere.
Over D.C. at
all. Over D.C.
But that's not true.
That planes are ready to go up to protect the White House and the Pentagon. I am telling you, it's all a farce. And
that's
the only
why they
way.
Use passenger planes, and there are passenger planes that fly that route.
Right,
the only way to protect our way of life, I'm talking about being able to lie down at night and know we're safe, is to eradicate, actually wipe off the map about 6 countries.
But you can't.
Yes, you
when
can.
When you have cockroaches, do you just kill the adults?
Why can't you?
No,
who do we care?
They don't know how to behave.
Whose opinion do we care about?
Because
why can't you?
Not because of opinion, but if you wipe out 6... Listen, I want revenge. I want all these firemen and cops, and I know people in the...
All right, and what's the downside of doing what I'm advocating?
It's the beginning of the end.
No, it's not.
It's so obvious.
No, it is not.
We're doing fine. We've done this before.
Not the beginning of the end. The beginning of the end for the 20,000 who are buried in that rubble. I don't want to be buried in the next rubble. I don't want to go. I don't want to jump out of the World Trade Center.
He acts like we've never done this before.
No, we have.
Oh,
we have.
Have you ever heard of a people called the Indians?
I'm not against it.
We wiped out the Indians, and you know why?
We don't have a problem.
How to settle
I'm
the
not
West?
Against it.
We had to live there.
That in terms of life and history, of all our lives, this is the most important day of our life.
Oh, please, Dominic. You don't even have much life left.
Believe me, you're going to be gone anyway from your obesity.
Happen. I guarantee it will happen.
I can't wait for it to happen. So I
don't think they're going to kill enough people. I think they're just going to anger them.
They're going to kill a few.
No, they're going to kill a few.
And leave them to breed.
Don't believe that.
Yo.
They got to stop until Bin Laden's dead, at least.
You can't stop until about three to six major countries that harbor terrorists right now that we know of are completely flattened out.
We need to exact 1,000 times on what they did to us.
Right, yeah. A million times.
Whatever it takes.
They got to be hurt so bad. The future never forgets.
If you remember Japan, when we dropped the nuclear bomb, it was great. The next day, people's skin was gone. All you saw was bones.
Right.
But you notice, even the young people of Japan have never forgotten.
Never.
Thanking
they never. Now they make telephones.
That's what I'm talking about. Their children should know.
Yeah. Right. Now they make telephones and sushi. We got sushi from them.
Our
beautiful raw fish. Listen to me. If you eliminate what we now know as the Arab world, eliminate it today, this won't happen again.
But then you're talking about genocide.
Yes, I'm talking about it.
That's
in
right.
I'm talking about owning that.
Yes, it has. Japan learned their lesson.
But we did not wipe out Japan completely.
No, all right, so you know what we'll leave? We'll leave two or three countries.
When maybe does let genocide them, not
for the fun
work?
Of it.
When does it not work?
By the way,
World
do you...
World War II.
What are you talking about?
Serbia and Bosnia.
They
practiced genocide. They went after certain races and tried to
kill them. Yeah, but it was a race that wasn't doing anything.
Stalin practiced
Japan
genocide.
Japan is the best example of how we ended World War II.
Don't
the
go
Japanese.
For genocide.
Listen to me. Either you let them live or you let them die. You take a choice.
I agree.
We didn't wipe out Japan, though. And now
we took Japan, and the ones that were left lived. They learned the lesson very, very good.
And it's a show of power. And
you know what? I don't say it lightly. I don't want to see people die. But you saw. Yeah, now the Japanese, we get sushi from them. We get telephones from them. They play for the Mets. That's fine with me. They've learned their lesson.
They like to come over here and shop a little bit, and that's it.
When you have a meeting with them, they bow. I've had meetings with Japanese. They bow to me.
So maybe if we drop a few bombs over there.
Not a few bombs. I'm talking about nuclear.
There's the first one.
There's the plane hitting on CNN right now.
The first one.
And then you tell me how you're going to combat that.
Meanwhile, Ronnie was telling me some report that he heard on the news that said that there was an Iraqi insurance policy on one of the buildings they own here in New York. I guess they're allowed to own buildings here, these enemies of ours.
Yeah, was it down there?
No, it was in Washington, which is near the Pentagon.
Oh.
And they had called to up the insurance policy.
Just before this?
The day before. They couldn't get more insurance because it was, you know, they needed it quick.
Right, too quick.
If you don't think all those countries are in on this.
Well, that's exactly what
yeah.
I'm saying.
We just need some quick insurance.
You know,
comprehensive coverage.
Like upping our
we
coverage.
We need to comprehend our coverage. Yes, I need a little term, something on the basement.
Short-term, high coverage.
What we would like to do is insure ourselves in case of an attack by an airplane. Yes, the fall is coming, it's getting cold, the wind.
We don't trust your American pilots.
Right, exactly.
Do you have the airplane policy? Where the airplane hits your building?
Yes, let's just say a plane hits my building. filled with transcontinental fuel.
Okay, what is that policy?
If you think that these guys weren't all in on it, you're dreaming.
My God, there's evidence for you.
Yeah,
there's enough evidence for you right now to wipe out Iraq.
But our president is on
the Congress.
Oh, the other great thing?
Yeah, go ahead.
You know, they were fighting
over the budget. Give me
some good news. They were fighting over the budget. Nobody wants to spend money. Nobody knows where the money's going to come from. The Democrats want one kind of money. The Republicans want another kind of money. Yesterday, they gave the president a blank check.
Good.
They say spend whatever it takes.
Spend at will.
I mean, if this doesn't get the unholy, all hell loose of our military, why aren't we saying today, hey, Israel, go have some fun. Seriously.
Yeah, go nuts.
Go nuts. Do it, you know, go ahead.
Yeah,
kill everyone.
Israel got incredibly quiet.
I don't understand why we're waiting for coalitions. If it's war, it's like we didn't sit there and go, listen, Rommel's in the desert. Let's think about when we're going to go get him.
Well, yes,
just
we
go
did.
Get him. No, we didn't.
We did.
No, once we went to war, we got him.
We waited a long time.
No, I don't mean that.
Long time to get into that
once
war.
We were in the war. If we're at war, let's go to war.
Well,
and let people fight.
The whole rap is, which I don't agree with, is,
we don't really know who to declare war on, but you're saying
they
do.
Of course we know. Of course they know. Anyone who has been our enemy is who's at war with us. If it's Iran and Iraq who has been screaming for years and harboring terrorists, we know they have. Okay, that's easy. I'll give you some easy ones.
Of war, we need fuel.
We have it.
No, we don't.
Yes, we do.
We don't have that much fuel.
Israel will take care of it. We can't get any fuel.
His question to you, Howard, was that now that you're so happy, do you need as much therapy?
I said I'm happy.
You're happier.
Well, you're happier than
I'm happier,
you were.
But I'm also, I don't know that I'm happier.
No, my question was, since you've been in a steady relationship like now, would you say you are coming to terms with yourself and need less psychotherapy treatment?
No way. I need more.
Really?
I'm a mess.
When is it going to end?
It doesn't end.
I don't know, but I don't seem to be getting that much better.
The way Howard plays it, it sounds like it ends in the casket.
Yeah.
I mean, you seem like, could you ever be happy?
No.
Yeah, see, I think you believe that.
Oh, I know I couldn't.
Why? What's the hang-up? I mean, what?
I have mental issues. I have a weird way of looking at life. There's some people who are just negative.
But you're the first guy to tell everyone, get over it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I know, but you know what I'm saying? It's just like I have nagging things that just don't go away.
Like what?
I know.
I'm uptight.
Really?
I'm superficial. I'm shallow.
So can you embrace that part of you?
No, but you want to feel things. I have absolutely no emotion. I mean, I want to be able to be, like, I want to be passionate about stuff.
You said that when you and your wife broke up, you know, when you had to tell the kids, you cried.
Yeah.
That you felt something.
Yeah, that I did.
So you're not a
stone. Yeah, but you got to go through catastrophic events to feel something with me.
Did you cry at all after the events of the World Trade Center at all, over anything that had anything to do with that?
I didn't cry about the, per se, World Trade Center, but I know I got very sad about my life, meaning because the effect of the World Trade Center, it definitely altered my perceptions.
But you didn't see any particular story that made you so sad?
Yeah, I did. I told you, I read one of the stories on the air that made me really sad.
Okay, so you're not...
I don't want to go into my psychological
problems. Did you
cry
again?
Yes.
Really? Like, bald?
I didn't cry.
I was that bald. I mean, I shed a tear. I can't remember what it was, but I saw some story about, you know, they showed some, you know, guy with 10 kids, and all the kids were, like, hugging their mom, asking where dad. It was one of those really...
I had a weird crying thing going on the other night. I was dreaming, you know? I was dreaming that I was hugging my 8-year-old daughter. I was holding her, like, just holding her in my arms, and I was walking in this, like, field of grass, and I kind of ached for her so much that I started to cry in my dream, and I woke up and I was crying, and I couldn't stop crying for over an hour.
You're right. Don't give up the therapy.
Yeah, I'm telling you. How weird is that?
Because that's pretty heavy.
Yeah.
You kept crying for an hour?
Over an hour. I couldn't stop it.
That's really hard.
That never happened to me in my life.
Wow. Because you start crying and you just make yourself stop.
I couldn't.
But
maybe
good.
Maybe
that's good
thing,
right?
Maybe.
Yeah, that's my. Yeah. I'm going to go tell the shrink I did that.
You know what? You were somehow released your emotions.
Give me a gold star.
And he'll go, coma.
Somehow imagine released. Your therapist goes, dang it.
You fake!
By the way, have you seen the protests starting against the war?
Yeah.
The Sheep Meadow, whatever they call that.
Sheep's Meadow, they had a protest.
Yeah, they said there was, I don't know, 80,000 or 20,000 people there.
Who were against invasion of Iraq.
Tim Robbins.
Yeah,
Tim Robbins.
You know what they're all saying? They're all like, you know, we said for years Russia was going to blow us up, but we knew if they if we attacked them, they'd counterattack. And I'm like...
This isn't Russia.
Nipped this one in the bud. See, that's what I told...
In fact, Tim Robbins said the stupidest thing. If he ever thought he was smart...
What did he say?
He said, we should be concentrating on the real problems.
What is that?
The economy and education.
What a pussy.
I'm like, you know, if we're not here, we can't do that.
Yeah. That guy should go live in Afghanistan.
Well, maybe the economy would be better if the Arabs didn't blow up those buildings.
Right, yeah, they didn't knock down, you know, 16 square feet of territory.
You know what the problem is? The problem is this. Bush didn't act fast enough. He should just start blowing stuff up that right after 9/11, when everybody was, you know, got war fever.
Before these guys could get themselves together and think of an argument.
Yeah, before anyone could open your yap.
Barbara Streisand is involved in this. And, you know, unfortunately, even Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward.
Well, they're too old to figure out what's right now.
You know, but I even hear Jane Fonda rattling her saber.
President Bush is listening to too many people. You got to just go in and invade.
But you know what? Why wouldn't we, right? And I was talking to somebody who lives in the United States but from a foreign country.
And they were like, well, we need to go, what we need to do is we need to, we don't have to use force, we should talk this out. I said, you can't have a rational discussion with irrational people.
We talked for 11 years, the guy won't let us in.
We've been talking.
Yeah, it's enough talk.
But even like, why would Tim, what does Tim Robbins say? We shouldn't go there because why? Because they're going to kill us.
Well, Tim Robbins forgets what, he wasn't in a building in 9/11.
He's still here.
He's still walking around enjoying, you know, Hollywood money, and he's a dickhead.
But is he thinking that we're supposed to be, like, nice and gentle and just sort of figure it out?
Oh,
just,
yeah. The UN is... We created the UN so we could handle problems.
You know how effective the UN is and how great they've been over the years. So, anyway, let's take a break.
And they're taking the lead on this one, too. Very well.
You know what? I turned on the TV this morning to see what was going on, and I'm, you know, watching the war, and the bombing has started, and it's a very sort of horrible feeling. It is a it's a weird war, because we have to instigate the war. We're starting the war, but we really didn't start the war. There's terrorism. People don't see this. There's terrorism, and it's getting worse, and these guys they got to get bombs dropped on their heads. And it's a sad thing, because innocent people will be hurt. But there's something tacky, I guess, about having the Academy Awards while something as serious as this is going on. There's something that does rub me the wrong way about, you know.
Well, when you think about, I was thinking about this the other day. There is no group of people who need to be honored more than actors and actresses. They have award show after awards. They can't stop thanking themselves for being so wonderful.
And we're willing to put up with it in times of peace because
nothing's going on.
It's fun, and we like looking at movie stars, and we like watching them give speeches, and we like to see what they're wearing. But in light of the war going on, and I didn't realize it until I saw the war going on. This is the beginning of the war. Bombs are being dropped. Guys are fighting. Reporters are covering it. It does feel a little Super Bowl-ish, you know, the whole thing. But yet there's this stink of war and the horror of it. And the thought of Sunday seeing these people get up and accept awards is a little bizarre.
For what? Yeah, real people are doing something really serious.
Right.
And then they're going to award themselves for standing in front of cameras.
Well, so the thing is, they really should announce the winners in a press release this year. And that should be it.
Yeah, be done with it.
Although me and Robin are going to some fancy-schmancy Oscar viewing party.
Because they're
going to
keep going.
They're giving us a $25,000 gift basket. I don't want to miss out on that.
Look at you guys.
Yeah.
Essentially, I'm making a run to pick up a gift basket.
Me too. We got a call. This is so funny. So maybe we want the Academy Awards.
Yeah,
we don't want our party gifts.
I saw the list of party gifts, and I went, okay, I'll go.
25 G's for the basket?
Well, this is what they say.
Right.
You know, who knows? It's probably a bunch of crud, but it was either go to Stuttering John's party or go to this party, and I went, he ain't giving me 25 grand.
That's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
I know what's in the basket, too.
What's in it?
It's like a lot of little stuff, but it adds up. I think there's a weekend at the Palm Hotel in Atlantic City. There's some, like, massage certificates. There's some sort of diamond necklace. There's a cell phone. There's a lot of stuff that your girlfriend will like.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing it for.
Yeah.
Wow.
That'll be nice. Congressman Gary Ackerman's on the phone.
Ah.
He's been briefed. So I'm wondering what's going on. Congressman, thanks for calling.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Congressman, give me how many days is it going to take to wrap up?
We really don't know.
Give me a guesstimate. 2 days?
Oh, stop.
It's going to be certainly more than that.
Here's what I'm praying for. I hope that our president doesn't do what his dad did. He's got to finish the job. In other words,
it's not over until you get Saddam Hussein.
We got to kill Saddam Hussein. And let's not capture him and then send him into exile. That's just going to piss a lot of people off, especially people who lost people in 9/11.
Absolutely right.
Well, if he's captured, they're not going to let him go.
See, I think a lot of world leaders don't like to assassinate a dude because then they're afraid of their own assassination.
Well, I don't think the guy's calling up George Bush and saying, hey, George, tell me about that timeshare thing again. How's that work?
Yeah, because
I think that the game plan here is to eliminate Saddam Hussein, and that's That good. Shot we took a few hours ago in trying to get lucky was an indication of that, to be able to end that, you know, 1, 2, 3, and not do any so-called collateral damage and have civilians die in this thing who have nothing to do with this.
Because if we let them live, he might go back to being a terrorist from some other country.
There's
well,
no
I think
way.
The world will be very happy if he was not a part of it. And
that's
I
right.
I think hopefully that's what's going to happen. Basically, he's moved all of his troops around Baghdad. His whole guard that's loyal to him, which is about 50,000 men, which means he's going to hold the entire city captive and say, you know, you want a piece of me, you're going to have to come in here, do it block by block, and you have to kill a lot of innocent people. It's like the terrorists who run and, you know, blow up people in the middle of Jerusalem, and then they go run and hide in the mosque and say, you can't hit me now.
What kind of bunkers do you guys have access to? Like if, you know, let's say this acts
yeah, what's
terrorism.
Under Congress?
Yeah, like, what do you...
I'm
like,
heading for the nearest bar. I
yeah, you go get loaded. So, yeah, I'm all for this. I'm one of those people that believes that we need retribution for 9/11. We do have to hunt down terrorists. And I'm just saying, there's a terrorist who funnels money, big money, into terrorism. I do believe the people of Iraq are enslaved by him. I do believe that if he was a decent man, there wouldn't be 60% of his own people starving. You know, he would give some money to his own people, some of that
yeah,
oil
why
money.
Not enrich
he's
the
a,
country?
He's a megalomaniac. He's a mass murderer. He's a hateful person. His sons are just as bad, especially the older one.
Worse.
It is a horror and a nightmare under which these people live. And there are not too many Iraqis that you meet who are out of the country who have a good word to say about Saddam Hussein or the regime.
One of his sons steals cable television. I read this.
Yeah, and he really cable. Needs to be taken down.
He needs to be taken out. But, you know, and here's the thing.
Get me his address.
Congressman, will I be seeing 12 cents a gallon at the pump? If I hope so. Okay. I wish we could just take their oil, take it from them.
Well, you know, that's part of the angst that's been caused in the Arab world, and they say our motives are basically to come in and take the oil. You know, we could do that at any time.
Right.
You know, and
we could have done it years ago.
We go in there, and if we wanted, we could make them the 51st state.
Right.
Then we'd have problems. Then we'd have all the people marching in the street. You know, the desert is pristine. We shouldn't be drilling for oil there. Let's do something else. We'd have that problem.
And will you watch March Madness Saturday, or will you watch the war on TV? Well, that's a tough choice.
Tough choice, and we don't know what's going to be canceled. I guess it depends on the next 2 days.
Right. And what about the Academy Awards? Should they be canceled?
I have no opinion on that. They're going to have to make a decision on that. I believe that life basically has to go on while these things are happening.
But we don't really need an Academy Award.
No, we never did. No. I just think it's in poor taste while people are fighting and this and that, and I'm calling for them to just read the announcement. Although I am due a $25,000 gift basket if I go to that party with you, Robin. All right, listen, Congressman.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for calling in. If you hear anything really, you know, really something
earth-shattering.
I'll give you a call.
Got him.
Yeah, and do me a favor. You and your guys in Congress, you know I'm a fan of yours, deport Susan Sarandon and that creep.
Sean Penn.
Deport them. Let's get busy.
It may start a precedent, but I'm not sure if it's a good or a bad one.
I don't know that there's any country that would take them.
Well, you know, my feeling was you have to really buy some island out in the Pacific somewhere where you put all the bad guys.
Yeah.
Send them to Bahrain.
And their fans.
All right. Congressman, thank you. That's Congressman Gary Ackerman working hard for you.
From the houseboat.
And giving us a little insight into what's going on in Washington. Evidently,
good work.
The houseboat is going on in Washington. Yeah, keep up the good work, Congressman, and let us hear from you.
Take care now.
Bye-bye.
Make sure I'm safe. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm such an asset to this country that...
Do you have guards around you?
Yes. Captain Jordan, you're on the air.
Hey, how you doing? This is Captain Jordan from San Clemente Base, 420.
Yes, Captain.
I just wanted to thank you, Howard, for being so appreciative for us warriors over here.
I am very appreciative. You're brave men. I recognize what you're about to do. You're doing something most people don't have the balls to do. And, Captain, we all appreciate you. Please send my love to the troops.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Howard. We really appreciate you.
Thank you, Captain. Everyone is checking in. Congressmen, captains.
Joan Rivers.
Joan Rivers. Everyone. Mr. Skin. And others. I'm trying to give people reasons to hate Saddam Hussein. If you don't have enough reasons, some people actually can't find the energy to hate him. Here is an email I got. The first paragraph alone justifies getting rid of Saddam Hussein.
Okay.
There was a machine designed for shredding plastic. Men were dropped into it, and we were again made to watch. Sometimes they went in head first and died quickly. Sometimes they went in feet first and died screaming. It was horrible. I saw 30 people die like this. Their remains would be placed in plastic bags, and we were told they would be used as fish food. On one occasion, I saw Kwasi, President Saddam Hussein's youngest son,
or Qusay,
personally supervise these murders. Now, this is one of many witness statements that were that was actually taken by researchers from Indict, which is an organization, I guess, that provides evidence for legal cases against specific Iraqi individuals for war crimes.
Mm. Yeah, well, they say the sons are pretty bad.
Yeah, because that article I gave you is about, is it Qusay?
Yeah.
Qusay and Uday.
Uday and Qusay. Yeah.
Yeah, this is some, this is what they do with Olympic, actually, Iraq has an Olympic team.
An Olympic team, I didn't know that.
Any athletes, this is any athletes, but especially, they put, Uday was in charge of
the Olympic team.
Right, they put him in charge in 1980.
This is a story of a boxer. Uday Hussein meets up with the boxer. The boxer knew what would awaited on the other side of a double entrance door.
He lost the bat. He lost the match.
He just returned from a Gulf States competition where he had been knocked out in the first round.
Oh, boy.
Oh, man. This is amazing. Now it was time to pay the price. Inside the yellow and blue office, Uday, the older of Iraqi President Saddam Hussein's two sons, paced the floor, waving his expensive Cuban cigar and glaring out the floor-to-ceiling windows overlooking Baghdad. He was yelling about Iraq, how they should not be embarrassed by athletes, blah, 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 blah. His voice rising, he walked around the desk and gave the boxer a lesson. This is how you box, he screamed, as he threw a left and a right straight to the fighter's face. Now, mind you, the boxer is manacled in the room by the Iraqi Secret Service, so the guy can't fight back.
Right, yeah. This is the only way Uday could actually get a punch off.
Blood dribbled from the athlete's nose as Uday launched another round of punches. Then, using the electric prod he was famous for carrying, Uday jolted the boxer in the chest. Blood was streaming from a cut above the boxer's eye when Uday ordered his guards to fetch a straight razor. The boxer cried out as Uday held the razor to his throat. As he moved the blade to the fighter's forehead, Uday laughed. He then shaved the man's eyebrows, an insult to Muslim males. Take him downstairs and finish the job, Uday screamed. They took him in the basement of the Olympic building. It had a 30-cell prison where athletes and anyone else who is out of favor with Uday are beaten and tortured. That was the last anyone ever heard of from this boxer.
That boxer? Mm.
Howard, you know what you got to talk about in there? What he did to the soccer team. This is in this week's Sports Illustrated, but that's a story that's going around.
By the way, Uday's nickname is the Butcher Boy.
Right. Well, you know, Uday killed his first person at the age of 16. His teacher embarrassed him in front of his girlfriend, so Uday killed him.
Yeah. By 16, he bragged of committing his first murder.
Oh, I thought the... Well, I guess they maybe were about that age when the father told him to go shoot some people.
Yeah. And Uday was embarrassed by his teacher because his chick was standing by, so he killed the teacher.
But Uday had been hanging out with his dad a long time. His dad started teaching him how to do stuff when he was 5 or 6.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, people were killed in front of them at an early age.
Oh, yeah,
So, by the way, now we talk about the Olympic soccer team.
Yeah.
And Uday's whole plan was to rebuild the spirit of the nation's youth. And he also wanted to prove to his father that he'd be a great successor by building the soccer team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that would be showing his worth. And, anyway, Iraqi sports today are worse than ever.
Yeah, he's not the successor anymore.
The deal was that they put him in charge of making sports better in the country. They're saying that Iraq had 40 athletes at the 1980 Olympics. Now they're down to 4 because nobody wants to compete.
Yeah, they had 46 athletes in 1980. Now they're down to 4. That's right. Amnesty.
In fact, they say, you know, Uday was actually, there was an assassination attempt on his life. He is absolutely hated, and somebody did try to kill him.
Yes, he's now like almost in a wheelchair.
Amnesty International reported in 2001 that Uday had ordered the hand of a security officer at his Olympic headquarters to be chopped off 5 years earlier after the man was accused of stealing sports equipment that was missing. But meanwhile, the missing equipment later turned up. The guy didn't do anything.
And the hand was gone. The hand didn't reappear.
In 1997, FIFA, the governing body of world soccer, sent two investigators to Baghdad to question members of the Iraqi national team who allegedly had their feet caned by Uday's henchmen after losing a World Cup qualifying match. Can you imagine that? The investigators, of course, only got to speak to the people Uday chose to be spoken to, and, of course, the result was Uday was exonerated.
Right.
So did the torture happen? Absolutely. When you interview athletes who are under Uday's control, they can't say anything. Listen to this. This is a guy who escaped from Iraq. I was tortured four times after matches. One time after a friendly match against Jordan in Amman that we lost 2-0. Uday had me and three teammates taken to the prison. When we arrived, they took off our shirts, tied our feet together, and pulled our knees over a bar as we lay on our backs. Then they dragged us over pavement and concrete, pulling the skin off our backs. Then they pulled us through a sand pit to get sand in our backs. Finally, they made us climb a ladder and jump into a vat of raw sewage. It's like Fear Factor, but worse.
Yeah.
They wanted to get our wounds infected. The next day, and for every day we were there, they beat our feet. My punishment, because I was a star player, was 20 lashings a day. Great to be the star player. I asked the guard how he could ever forgive himself. He laughed and told me if he didn't do this, Uday would do it to him. Uday made us athletes an example. He believed that if people saw he was not afraid to beat a hero, they would live in great fear. Oh, these people cannot wait to be liberated by us.
As a matter of fact, the United States is broadcasting over Iraqi radio, and they said the day you've been waiting for is coming. Right. It's the message we're sending
yeah.
to them.
I mean, they're lucky they have oil. That's why we're liberating them. Otherwise, they would be like those, you know, nations in the Congo where nobody helps
nobody
them.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares. This is a great day for the Iraqi people. And isn't Uday in a wheelchair?
Yes.
He walks with a cane and sometimes in a wheelchair.
Because Saddam Hussein tried to kill them.
Well, they think
no, his own Uday sons. was almost killed by somebody else, but Saddam also put one of his own sons in a wheelchair.
Well, they say that Uday they say that Uday had an assassination attempt on him, and it may have been his brother. They're not sure.
Yeah, but Saddam has another son that he actually wanted killed, and it just paralyzed him.
Oh.
He's like, oh, I wish they had really finished.
Well, that
the
might
job
be Uday because Uday's paralyzed.
No, he's not.
That's what it says in the article.
It
yeah.
does?
Yeah.
Uday's paralyzed?
Yeah, Uday is.
Wow. Well, then maybe he's the kid.
There was also a report that after a loss, Uday forced the volleyball team,
this is weird,
which was made up of taller athletes, to remain in a room he had constructed with a 5-foot-high ceiling. He built the room so small that not all of them could sit at the same time. The only way they could fit was by having half of them standing and leaning over while the other half were sitting with their knees in their chest. He considered this a motivational technique. What a weirdo.
His rap on that was, if you play small, you should feel small.
After years of Uday's abuse, it came as little surprise to the international community when he was the target of an assassination attempt in December of 1996. Uday was driving to a party in a two-car caravan. And there's a guy you want to party with.
Yeah.
With bodyguards. When gunmen peppered his car with a submachine gun. Uday was hit by 8 bullets and was rushed to the hospital. No one was arrested for the crime, leading experts on Iraq to believe that a member of Uday's family, possibly his brother, had masterminded the attack. The 6-foot-1 athletically built Uday survived, but he's partially paralyzed. Today he uses a wheelchair in private and limps with a cane in public. In years since the assassination attempt, Saddam has tended to favor Qusay as his successor.
Right, the younger one.
Yeah.
The one who doesn't limp.
The one they made limp and the one they didn't make limp. So anyway, that's what's going on over in Iraq.
Yeah, that's who we should deal with diplomatically.
Yeah, and that doesn't even say anything about Uday's rapes of women.
They have a rape room. Yeah, Cabby.
How you doing, man?
Hey.
Well, you know, what people need to realize, I was actually watching MTV last night, and they had some liberal scumbags on there talking about how during George Bush's speech, he talked about how Saddam's going to use civilians as human targets, you know, and he tried to word it like George Bush was making it so that we're going to, you know, so that it was going to be okay that civilians were going to die. You know, when we were there last time, Saddam, when he ran from Kuwait, he went through some of his own cities and killed his own people and tried to make it look like we did it. That's how evil this guy is. You see what I'm saying?
What?
Don't you feel like you have to give Kevy some level of respect because he was there the first time, but really you don't?
I give Kevy respect because he yelled into the telephone and you're afraid to disagree with him. Let me tell you something.
You know, and also we need to really, really get behind our troops right now because
we are.
No, I know, but there's a lot of tree huggers out there who are saying, oh, you know, we need to fight, we need to have peace and all this and that. You know what? At what price is George Bush going to be proven right?
He will be proven right by history. This is
no, I know, but what I'm saying is how many people are going to die when Saddam uses chemicals?
Right. Well, listen, anybody with any common sense understands what's going on. We have to hunt down. This is the beginning, by the way. This is the beginning of the war on terrorism. If anyone doesn't have the stomach for it, this is not the end. This isn't the end game, by the way.
You know what he
exactly.
did? You know what Bush did that I thought I was really proud of? Just last night, just for argument's sake, he threw some strikes over in Afghanistan.
Right.
To say, you know, we're not done with you guys either.
No, in fact, they think they took out some more Taliban al-Qaeda guys who have come back to Afghanistan to try some shenanigans.
Right, because they think, oh, well, they're in Iraq now, so we'll go hide out in Afghanistan.
They never expected a president that would bomb the hell out of them.
You're right.
This is their worst nightmare. And the only reason there haven't been more terrorist attacks recently is because they're on the run.
I'm driving down the BQE right now on Staten Island, and there's a sign on the freeway, and it says, Sharon is a war criminal. Now, what does that mean?
It's a lunatic who wrote on the side of a tunnel.
It's ignorance.
It was funny because I heard some woman say this morning that, oh, dear, now we're going to have to worry about, you know, there's a greater threat of terrorism happening here. We'll have to get used to the new greater threat. And one of the people in government says it's pretty much like the old threat.
Right.
It was there. We were going to get hit again.
Let's remember something. We've disrupted. You got to give the president credit. He has disrupted the way these guys do business. They had this Afghanistan. They were running a fiefdom. They had money coming in, money coming out. They got these guys on the run. Now, I'm not saying they got all these guys on the run. I'm not naive. I know that
right.
there are terrorist cells. I know there's all kinds of things. But if you start tying this president's hands, you wanted a war. You just go back to 9/11.
Yep.
Think about what that was like watching the Twin Towers go down. These guys would still be doing it.
Oh, yeah.
These guys... would so totally be out there up to their shenanigans.
And no matter what we do, whether we sit here and not do anything or go to war, they're still going to try to plan their attacks.
Dennis Miller said a cool thing. He said, you know what? Saddam Hussein and Osama bin Laden are not going to go to the UN and wait for approval when they attack us.
Exactly. And you know what? Think of how many of these little monsters that we snuffed out that you never read about in the newspaper.
That's right. Guys who were going to come over here and do secret missions.
Exactly. That you never read or never saw their hairy back picture on the front page of the New York Post.
That was and the reason we haven't been attacked again is because the president has been so busy.
He's exactly. very busy. And let me tell you something. They got to give another thought now to masterminding more of these kinds of attacks. And I'll tell you why. These guys have a lot of money coming in because of oil. And they don't want to give up their way of life.
And only half doing the job will only create more problems.
That's right.
And that's why last night when Bush said the only thing that we're going to do is I don't know how he said it. I'm not as eloquent, obviously. But victory is the final solution. That was the best thing he said. That's it.
He's doing a good job. And he's going to be applauded for it. That's all. All right, Kevy, thanks.
Hey, bro.
If they were doing nothing about this war.
Don't forget, man.
If they were doing nothing about terrorism, if they were doing nothing about 9/11, I'd be furious right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, they did nothing about terrorism through the 90s. And
that's
look
right.
Look where it got us.
Nowhere.
Look where it got us.
Got us 9/11.
That's exactly what I'm saying, that sitting around trying to appease people and hoping that they won't attack you is not the way to go.
Never worry. It's never worked in a schoolyard. It's never worked with bullies. And it's never going to work on a world stage.
How many times did countries give Osama bin Laden to Clinton in their hand, and he said, you know what, I don't want any problems, just leave him there, we don't really need him.
At least three times, at least three.
Exactly, and look what happened.
All right, Kevy, thanks.
Thanks, man.
That's Kevy. Actually got through a whole call without plugging Trim Spa.
Yeah, he must be serious.
Hey, Vinny, yeah, he's obviously a very serious guy. Vinny, go ahead.
Yes, I have a question about Saddam, and then if it's not inappropriate, I want to talk about the Oscar viewing party. last night, did you see the speech when he went on last night, Saddam?
Saddam's speech?
Yeah.
No.
You guys didn't see it at all?
We saw Saddam's speech.
It didn't look like him at all. It looked like one of the doubles, and it looked like it was on tape.
There was speculation that that was a double.
Yeah, they don't know whether he's alive or dead yet. He could have made 50 tapes.
But he looked horrible.
In
anticipation
of being killed so that we would think he was alive for a lot longer, because he actually says the date, apparently, to give you the impression that he is there.
But he wasn't surrounded by his key people who are in all the videos to show that he's...
Let him hold up a newspaper.
He's like a hostage. Okay, shifting to the party, Robin. Do you need a wardrobe for the party? Because they want to dress you up.
What? I'm going to dress down because there's a war.
Okay.
No, you're not.
No, Robin, take advantage
of this. Why are we going to the party otherwise?
That's the whole point.
When do I have to be in wardrobe?
Well, no, here's the deal. They'll send it. We'll get you on the phone. We'll get you, like we did with Beth. We'll get you measurements.
Do it.
Oh, they do that? Okay.
Yeah.
But you got to call. Like, I need you to call me so I could put you on the line with the person.
I'll talk to you after the show.
Okay,
how about that?
Call me.
That's no fun. We want to hear it now.
Yeah, actually, the conversation with Beth and the woman yesterday.
I want to hear Robin go, you know, don't forget my bust is very big.
She looks incredible, by the way. I can't believe you guys didn't notice. I saw her for the
first time. I noticed everything, believe me. Calm down.
Sure.
I'm not going to comment.
It had disappeared. They'd still be talking to me. Fred be playing my laugh.
Robin, you had no work done. I mean, that was all natural, what you did?
Yes.
Wow.
I'll be quiet.
No, with the hair extension,
Vinny.
I don't have any hair extensions. That's my
Robin,
hair.
Robin, how stunned was I when I saw you?
Oh, he was amazing. He was like, oh, my God, what did you do?
I was ready to jump on top of him.
All right, Vinny, this is a great conversation for off the air.
Okay, I'm sorry. So, Robin, I need you to call me so I can get you.
I will talk.
Whatever you need for the party.
Yeah, we're going to an Oscar party where they pay you to go.
But Howard, you want
more or less. I mean, they give you this gift basket supposedly worth 25 G's.
It's just a thank you, not a bribe, is what
right,
you're saying.
Right.
But it's Entertainment Weekly's party, but the funny thing is I'm negotiating with the person that Gary is a celebrity because I really want him to come as a celebrity as opposed to as because he won't come if he comes as himself.
They just don't want to give him a gift basket.
I think, but you know what? Like, he should be there. He's the biggest producer there.
I don't care as long as I'm there. And I'm going.
No, that's great. And I think that'll make it easier for me.
They're sending a car for me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're gonna dress Beth, and they're going to give me a gift basket.
Why not go?
So I'll go.
Now, what happens with this wardrobe after? Do we get to keep it?
I don't think so. I think it's promotional consideration only.
I see.
And, Robin, while you're in your wardrobe fitting, if anything happens with the war that's big, we'll let you know.
Thank you.
All right. I mean.
Yeah. All right. I got to take a break. We'll do the rest of the news right after this. Robin, what's in the news?
He doesn't even care to watch the games. He just wants to bet.
Yeah, he won't even watch them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't wait to bet.
That's amazing. Well, Vinny was on a little while ago and was asking if we had heard Saddam Hussein's speech. Here is a little bit of it. He went on the air in Iraq to assure the Iraqi people that he was still there and to admonish the U.S. for these attacks. Here is Saddam Hussein. D1.
Take out the sword and break them down. Only the resolute people will be victorious.
You know what? Call me ignorant, but I can't stand to hear him talking in the background with that guy over him. I hate it. But it doesn't match. I mean, Saddam Hussein is angry.
Uh-huh.
And this guy's like, hey, he says he's really not happy about being bombed. But he's going to do what he has to do.
Meanwhile, he's screaming, I hate you, you suck.
You suck, you piece of garbage.
They'll die like American pigs.
It's not good.
You think the translator should be screaming as well? He should.
Yeah.
Should he also relay the emotion?
Plus, Saddam is so loud. I mean, they can adjust the volume. Saddam is so loud, I can't even concentrate. There's a madman yelling in the background.
Oh, that's what I always think of so funny.
The guy should be like, look, between you and me, la, 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 la. This man feeds babies into a meat grinder. I gotta remain calm. La, 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 la.
Head towards the hills.
This guy's crazy. Kill him. You should hear what he's saying behind me. La, 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 la. La, 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 la. He says... Ba 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 The man makes no sense. Speak English, you bastard.
Just keep
rattling
on.
Here, listen.
Don't let him save
the sword.
He's like,
blah, 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 blah.
The sword. That sounded like a whole sentence. How could it just be the sword?
Blah, 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 blah.
The sword.
Blah, 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 blah.
Is.
Blah, 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 blah.
Big.
Thank you.
Hey, what is that?
Take the sword without any fear. Take out the sword.
And by the time he says something, it doesn't make any sense. You don't even know. It's just awful.
Yeah, he couldn't possibly be keeping up with the
dog. He says the sword must be taken from the other man's hand, inserted into a... and to be done. And you go, what the hell?
First of all, when's the last time a war was fought with swords?
See, that's why Saddam is going to lose.
Let them be witness to that.
Oh, thank you very much.
He says, Mel has re-signed with Viacom.
There is good news and bad news.
Would you like the good news first? Your lunch is canceled.
Oh, dear. Meanwhile, here is what it sounded like when President Bush went on TV last night to announce that the attack had begun. D3.
American and coalition forces in the early stages of military operations to disarm Iraq, to free its people, and to defend the world from grave danger.
Saddam Hussein says, deck the halls with balls of holly.
La 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 la.
Fa la 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 la.
That was literal.
Yes.
E1 is the president explaining why we must take the war to Saddam now.
We will meet that threat now with our army, Air Force.
This is the debate we've been waiting for.
We do not have to use of firefighters and doctors on the streets.
Yeah, that would have been some debate. Here is the sound of
Saddam Hussein singing.
No.
He says, dirty deeds done dirt cheap.
Oh, stop. This is what you heard in Iraq shortly after the president's announcement, E2.
Wow, imagine being in the middle of that.
Oh, awfully loud.
I got a feeling those are all our bombs.
Oh, of course. They only send off one Scud.
Yeah, and we got it with a Patriot missile.
Right, yeah.
Shortly after the bombs went off, Saddam said this. Let me out of here. Quick.
So the war has started.
Could he even be in the country? I bet he's not even there. We're never going to get this guy.
I told you, he's in an underground bunker somewhere. Whoever they saw roaming around, that probably wasn't Saddam.
Hey now. Good morning, everybody. What's happening? Hey now. So much to talk about. So much to talk about. But we got to take a break. We got to take a break. See, we got the Academy Awards to talk about, the various... You know, well, let's just talk about me. That's all that matters.
Yeah.
Got to talk about the war. Didn't realize it was going to be such a tough march through Baghdad.
You know, they're doing some of those Vietnam tactics, these scumbags.
Hey, can I tell you something? The problem is, again, like Vietnam, we're being too nice. Like, we're making sure we don't hit certain targets, and we're being nice. So the I think we should have done 2 weeks of bombing before we even put a foot soldier in there.
Right.
Hey, how weirded out are you by the live coverage of the war? Have you seen some of it?
Yeah, I know.
I mean, they've got some of the guys mic'd. You know, some of the main guys.
Yeah.
And at one point, this guy's on his he's on his stomach.
Big mistake, by the way.
With a machine gun.
Yeah.
And they're going, so if you see somebody come out with a white flag, what are you going to do? And he's like, well, nothing. And they go, if they don't have a white flag, you're going to shoot him? And the guy's like, yeah. And it was just like, they're like 100 yards away.
Everybody's discussing what to do.
It's just shoot him.
It's a big mistake having. It's a real big mistake having all those reporters along.
Well, you know what they're doing.
I'll tell you why. It's a politically correct war. It's to show, aren't we nice? We're there.
Yeah, we're the good war people.
We're there to liberate people who don't even apparently care if we liberate them or not. And really, the way that we handle these guys is to bomb the hell out of them for 2 weeks, like we did in Afghanistan, and then come up and let them come up for air and then beat their ass with guns. I mean, it is odd that we have to fight a politically correct war.
Yeah, but we can't hit civilians. That's
right.
our new thing now.
Yeah, because I saw in the news, like, you know, like two kids or something got hit in a school bus
then
or something.
Then we go, ah!
Yeah, right.
How much would you have to be paid? Why would somebody who's not in the Army go out there and report?
Because they're crazy.
Because they want an anchor job one day.
They want to be like Dan Rather. Right. This is their big moment.
I'm looking at bombs going off, and the guy's wearing a helmet. And I'm
crazy.
We pay the Army guys. They're there for a reason.
Yeah.
You have no good reason to be there.
Crazy.
But, you know, how did Dan Rather become Dan Rather?
Right.
He had to be in a tense situation.
He was in Vietnam. But he lucked out. He was there when Kennedy got assassinated.
Right.
That was a bigger thing for him.
Yeah.
But I was just saying, you have to be where the news is.
Yeah, evidently. Or you have to be really hot.
Yeah.
That helps.
But if you're hot and you're where the news is, remember the Scud Stud from the first Gulf War? Yeah,
that's true.
He went into hiding. He got so famous.
Yeah. Chicks really wanted him. Everybody, what's happening? Let me take a break.
Once again. You know, John,
does anybody want to hear Debbie Schlussel talk about why Michael Moore is a liar?
A liar. Okay.
No. So anyway, with Ben.
I'm intrigued. Why is Michael Moore a liar?
Debbie.
Hi. Well, you know, he was saying that we have lived in a fictitious world and the fictitious president and all that crap.
Yeah.
Well, his movie, Bowling for Columbine, which is supposed to be a documentary, so it's supposed to be somewhat truthful, it's full of fiction. I mean, there's all lies in it. He says that he bought a gun at a, he got a gun at a bank for opening a bank account, and that's not true. The bank does not allow people to get guns at the bank. He states the whole thing. They make you go through a background check and pick it up at a gun shop. So there's no danger of people having guns at the bank. I mean, that's BS.
So in other words, he lies, too. He's fictitious.
Exactly. He's more fictitious than anyone. You know, he tries to pretend he's a blue-collar guy. He lives in a $1.2 million apartment in New York, and he owns stocks in a lot of the companies that he says he's against in corporate America. Other things in the movie, you know, your friend of the show, Dick Clark, he confronts Dick Clark in the movie Bowling for Columbine. Did you see the movie, Howard?
No, I didn't. I have it, but I'm, you know, when I hear documentary, my eyes roll at the back of my head.
Well, he confronts Dick Clark because, I don't know if you remember, there was that six-year-old girl that was shot by the six-year-old boy in her classroom in Michigan.
Right.
And the mother, he says that the mother couldn't take care of her son because she was in a work-to-welfare program that we have here in the state of Michigan, and she was on her way on a bus to go work at Dick Clark's American Bandstand restaurant, which is at a mall here in the Detroit area. And he goes and confronts Dick Clark, and Dick Clark won't talk to him, and he blames Dick Clark for her son killing this little girl. Well, the fact is that she didn't even have her son. She gave him away to her brother who lived in a crack house. And that's where the brother was living with you know, her brother. I'm sorry, her son was living
See,
with
I don't know any of this.
I don't know.
I'm zoning, Debbie.
Okay, well, I'll tell you some other stuff. He said in Bowling...
you know what? We believe that Michael Moore is a liar.
Well, yeah, there was a whole article in Forbes magazine about all the lies in his movie. I mean,
you know what? I tell you what. Michael Moore got up at the Academy Awards and started to make an anti-Bush, anti-war statement. And you know what? I'm pissed the Academy Awards put that music on and cut him off. I disagree with him, but
well, the music wasn't because he was doing it. There was a certain time limit, and he
No, come on. I believe they cut him short.
Absolutely.
Listen, it's pretty long. It's 55 seconds, that whole thing.
But why would you stop the most exciting thing of the night?
Yeah, I mean, he's making a statement. People are reacting and booing. I don't know. It seemed like it got cut short, but because it was interesting.
I think it was the same as anybody else. He got
because Adrian Brody got like 3 minutes.
Adrian Brody made them stop, though. But the music came up, and Michael Moore didn't demand that
How long did he speak before they made him stop?
Okay, well, let's time it. I got the statement.
I got all of them.
Adrian Brody did like a three-minute speech.
He did 3 minutes
before. All right, but he had to stop the music.
No, before he stopped the music, I bet he did 2.5 minutes. I'll bet any amount of money.
Yeah, they made an allowance.
Well, let's listen.
All right. Hold on. I got it. I got it right here. I got it all queued up. Christ's sake. Stop it. You ready?
Okay, this is
Debbie, you ready?
Yes, I'm ready. I heard it, though.
And you know what? I'm pissed they stopped him. It was interesting. Okay, I disagree with him, but so what? Let's see what the guy's got to say.
What more was he going to say?
I don't know. He was making a funny statement at the end there that...
If the Pope and the Dixie Chicks are against you, it's time to go or something?
Yeah, that's funny. That it's funny.
Come on.
I mean, where's people's sense of humor?
Of what time to go.
All right, hold on.
More Iraqi.
Wait. Hold on. Got the wrong one. Okay, here we go.
As far as I remember, they were supposed to have 45 seconds, and he got more than 45 seconds before that music came
up. They gave him about 58 seconds.
They did.
But now play Adrian Brody. And I'll guarantee you
that
he got 2 minutes.
What number? Later on.
And he was a bore.
Yeah, he was all over the place.
12.
All right, this is boring, but we're doing this for timing purposes.
Oh, really?
This is official, yeah.
And we just want to see when the music first comes up for Adrian.
That's right.
Yay!
And then he goes on and on.
Yeah, I bet you he did about 3:45 in total.
Oh, I can tell you exactly what it was.
They got nervous with Michael Moore saying what he was saying.
Absolutely.
And as dumb as it might be, what he said.
All right, I got one more to compare it to. These are the guys who won for best sound. Number 8.
Oh,
they didn't do anything interesting.
I'm just saying.
The guy stuttered. What are you talking about?
Oh, that was great. Did you see him?
No.
Oh, Howard. The short guy gets up and goes, I want to thank this one. I want to thank that one. And this tall English guy, you can tell by looking at his English. And then he goes,
really? Best sound.
His whole head started
number
shaking.
Number 8.
The best sound guy stuttered.
Yeah. We want to thank him. See, you can't tell his head was shaking
right,
a lot.
He's going like this, you know, it's like. John, when he gets into a good one.
Well, I think it's funny that John was just laughing at the guy.
Well, what's
how long did Pedro Almodovar speak? He spoke a long time, too. You know, the last word where Ben Lowe suddenly got a Mexican accent there?
Yeah, Ben Lowe did a very good job with Itu Mama Tumpion.
Right, and then he goes, Pedro.
Meanwhile, look, here's the bottom line, everybody. Michael Moore was saying something at least interesting.
And
you
also,
know, aside from Steve Martin, who was brilliantly good at the beginning,
that
was funny.
Billy
was great,
By the time, Catherine Zeta-Jones, who's the size of a house, and Queen Latifah, who's the size of a whole condo, got up and sang boring music from Chicago, I was asleep. I mean, that was it. The night was over for me.
And Rob, would you admit that on some level, Michael Moore is a celebrity bigger than, much more well-known than the sound guys?
But the point is...
No, the documentary filmmaker is not that big.
No, but Michael Moore is.
Michael Moore is big.
The guy's got the number one...
It's not man, it's the award.
No.
Yeah, why is he a bigger deal? Because he makes anti-war statements?
No, because he's more...
He's a liar.
He's more well-known.
Listen, I'm a guy who's watching these Academy Awards. I'm falling asleep. Finally, somebody's saying something controversial.
I was glad they cut him off.
You were?
You know, in the middle of his speech.
I was upset they cut him off.
I want to see him make a fool of himself.
Yeah, let's hear what he's got to say.
They cut him
you know what?
This was one of the most exciting things of the night.
Yes.
He's a big fatso.
He's a big fatso who waddles up to the stage who could do nothing for anybody if they hadn't have a bunch of skinny cameramen following him.
I'm with you on all that, Robert. But
I agree.
I want to see him hang himself.
Let's see what he has to say that he's so brilliant.
He did it.
And how about the people in the audience booing him? It was great. It was great theater.
This might sound unpopular, but in the middle of him talking, I decided I'm against freedom of speech.
You're coming out against freedom of speech?
I'm coming out against freedom of speech. It's a controversial stance.
They all boo Michael Moore, yet they applaud Roman Polanski.
That was weird.
What the hell was that? Very weird. And they gave him the Best Director Oscar.
Oh, it's just...
I never thought they'd do that. Jeez.
And the chick he raped came up and accepted for him.
Yeah, she was nowhere to be found.
Yeah, I mean, can you believe this
guy? Who did accept for him?
Nobody.
They just, said we accept this in his honor because there was nobody there.
NAMBLA accepted for him.
You know, they had a lot of no-shows last night. I was surprised. Eminem didn't show up. And
He was never showing up.
No, there are some.
It's weird that, and there were a couple, the first award of the night, the guy didn't show up.
Some didn't because of the war.
Someone said Barbara Streisand looked like she'd been hit with a bat when Eminem, when she opened it up and saw Eminem won an award.
She was shocked.
Eminem.
It's like,
how dare they?
Well, imagine.
It is funny, to, you know, Bono sitting in the audience really just waiting to hear his name. Yeah. I mean, everyone said Bono was going to win.
Yeah.
And they make him perform, and he was about to jump up and.
Jack Nicholson not winning Best Actor. Again, I didn't see Adrian Brody, but
it was a good
Adrian Brody was great.
Yeah,
I don't care.
A really good performance.
Jack Nicholson was awesome.
So the hottest chicks of the night, how Halle Berry, gorgeous.
Yeah, let's talk hot chicks. Hey, Debbie, you got anything to say about hot chicks?
First of all, hot chicks, Howard, if you understand, they're against the jihad they're going on in Afghanistan. They're against Halle Berry because of the...
Julianne Moore had a bad dress.
Yeah, she's not a bad-looking old broad, but her dress was really bad. The color was wrong. She's all pasty.
I don't even Julianne think she's that old.
She's 42. 41, 42.
She's way old.
Really?
Oh, yeah. No,
she was in her 30s.
No, she's 41 or 42. You know,
she's a big mess.
I just realized it's fun talking Oscars with Debbie Schlesinger, because she's like, yeah, Gina Davis ballooned up to one of Saddam Hussein's body doubles, if you notice. Yeah, she just relates everything back to
the jihad.
Yeah, to the jihad.
Debbie, how is the war going? I got to take a break, but how is the war going? Are we going to win
you,
swiftly? What's going on? Just tell us your thoughts quickly.
Yeah, I think it's going really, really well. I mean, I think there are areas like Tikrit, which is Saddam Hussein's hometown, where we're going to have problems. And I think that we're going to have problems in other places. I mean, obviously, we know about what happened with the prisoners and with the people pretending to surrender. But listen,
I got to tell you, I thought it was a bad weekend. I thought that
it was
one of our own soldiers started grenading our own men.
Who was a Muslim, too.
Right.
Oh, wait a second. You mean intentionally?
Yeah.
Yes, he rolled 4 grenades into tents.
He's a Muslim.
He wanted to get back at his commanders because they had ridiculed him and weren't going to let him go out on a mission.
Yeah, but Howard, that wasn't true either.
He felt guilty.
This guy was an engineer who had never been with this particular platoon. He was a new guy, actually. So how could there have been resentment? I think he was planning this thing.
Yeah, maybe. But he was resentful, supposedly. And he started feeling guilty because he's a Muslim and he was fighting Muslims.
Then we shot down a British plane.
Then plus those two guys that we had who were Kuwaitis, they shot all the guys who were jumping out of the...
Hello?
Oh,
she disconnected herself because I didn't touch it.
The phone actually got bored with it.
I wanted to ask her.
The phone.
I was going to ask her, Saddam Hussein, dead or alive?
She's gone.
Like Debbie knows.
No, but it's fun to hear her say.
I know.
Well, Saddam Hussein, Gary.
Do you think he's dead?
I think he's alive.
He's alive.
But why did he make?
I think he's not even in the country.
Why did he make reference to a general that's already been captured?
And who surrendered?
He didn't.
They said he did. Yes, he did.
Did they?
Yeah.
Yes. He gave a speech. It was a very sort of generic speech. And when he was, he actually congratulated certain generals for the fighting. And then he mentioned a general who surrendered.
Well, let me tell you, he mentioned him, but he didn't say anything about him surrendering, did he?
No.
No, but he congratulated
him. He congratulates him for his defending of this town.
In an audio? It's just an audio speech.
Yeah, but he could have recorded that ahead of time.
Well,
he got lucky.
That's what they're saying.
Yeah, he did.
That they don't think this is a current speech.
Yeah.
This isn't something he just recorded.
That's what I'm saying.
So you're saying he's hiding, but he recorded these speeches in advance?
He's hiding. He recorded speeches in advance, which is amazing. I mean, that shows some sort of his plan was to record speeches in advance. Debbie, what is it?
Well, one other thing I want.
What happened to you?
I don't know. I was talking. All of a sudden, I was disconnected.
Al-Qaeda.
Well, one other thing I wanted to say is that, you know, the Saudis have this plan for when we take over, and we are going to take over. I mean, sure, there are going to be those things like that happen this weekend. And by the way, we have to get rid of Al Jazeera. You know, Kuwait kicked them out of Kuwait. We need to get rid of them from following our troops.
Yeah.
I really don't think that Al Jazeera is helping us.
Well, I've always said, I don't know why there is an Al Jazeera.
Well, Al Jazeera had that tape of our guys, our POWs.
Of course.
And that one kid laying down injured, American soldier.
I didn't see it.
They always have the best tape. They have Osama bin Laden. They have everything.
Right, they're the terrorist news network.
Well, there's a website showing it. That's how I saw it.
Out on Friday night, when did you see the thunder and light?
All right, we're going to talk about that later, because I got to take a break.
It's getting run on.
Debbie, thanks.
Thanks, Howard.
Debbie, anything else on Al Jazeera?
All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be back right after these words. Hey, Shuley, you're on the air.
Hey, Howard, how you doing, man?
Hey, now.
Hey, you hear about, I'm sure you talked about Peter Arnett thing, right?
Yesterday.
Yeah. Did you hear about Geraldo's now going to get kicked out of Baghdad?
Yeah, well, evidently when
that
he was...
That seems to be up in the air, though.
No, he's getting kicked out of Baghdad.
Yeah, I heard for sure.
The military escorted him out because he wasn't even in Baghdad, from what I understand. He was traveling with one of the divisions.
Right.
Did you see what he did?
Yeah.
the dumbest thing ever.
He basically... Geraldo was on there and started drawing where all the troops were in the sand.
He drew a map in the sand.
And you don't do that. That's aiding and abetting. Yeah.
You draw a line in the sand, not a map.
Hi, this is Geraldo. Here's where we are.
Let
exactly.
Show you exactly.
So they've told him 20 times, don't pinpoint where the troops are. And he, of course, did it. And now Geraldo. He's freaking out. And Peter Arnett.
You keep saying that they're not throwing him out. But you say they are?
They are.
Yeah, I heard tonight that they are.
I read in the paper today they are. Peter Arnett did something else. He went on Iraqi television and talked about how What?
I said he's just a piece of garbage for doing that.
Yeah. He went on Iraqi television and basically gave them a morale talk and basically said that our troops had planned to do this invasion and get it over with quickly, and basically our plan wasn't working.
Right. He says you guys are winning because you're great resistance.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the same television that shows the dead American soldiers shot and killed, you know?
But he's a real scummy dude because when he got into trouble, he started apologizing.
Yeah.
And then he got picked up after MSNBC fired him. He got picked up by some British news organization that's very anti-war.
Yeah.
And then immediately started crying, hey, I reported like I see it. Mm. You know, one minute he's apologizing. Oh, I'm sorry, sorry, sorry. Then after you fire him, he's like, oh, well, I reported the way I see it. I'll continue to do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's an American citizen. Kick him out. He's from New Zealand.
Believe him, man.
Janine Garofalo is weird. I got tape of her on the show You Hate Bill Maher show, but, man, she...
She's going everywhere talking crap, man.
But she's really got
what
it wrong.
Saying?
I mean, I'm all for dissent. I really am. But now that the war is going on and these guys are over there risking their lives... Let them have a morale boost. Calm down with the rhetoric for a few minutes. Give these guys a chance. Wait, that's 50 Ways to Kill Saddam. I'll play that in a minute.
I think I'd rather hear that.
You say there are no rules in warfare, none whatsoever? Like,
well,
shove them in a room and gas them is cool if that's what you got to
do?
No,
of course not. No, of course not.
I would say a preemptive, unprovoked strike is not fair. This is a preemptive strike that was not provoked. That is not fair.
How you can call a guy with a 20-year career as a terrorist who's tried repeatedly to launch terrorism?
Okay, we've supported the Ba'ath Party since 1968. He had Donald Rumsfeld's complete support until 1991. Right. That is such, you know, they use weapons of mass. They use gas on people.
Until 6 months ago, they're still scumbags.
Why? Oh, just because they disagree with you? That kind of worldview is so shockingly ignorant. It's amazing to me.
She's calling the guy dumb because he disagrees.
Isn't she supposed to tell jokes?
She hasn't told jokes in years. You know what her problem is? She really needs to be a lesbian. She needs to be gay because no guy's going to bang her. With
and
that
she's
mouth.
Angry.
And she's angry and just bitter and chubby. And if she...
going to show everybody she's smarter.
But if she was a lesbian, she'd have hot chicks like Melissa Etheridge does and Rosie O'Donnell does.
Yeah.
Life would be perfect if she was a lesbian. Her problem is she's into dudes.
She's at home. She would be at home if she was satisfied.
I know.
Amazing. Hey, by the way, that Scare Tactics show that's coming on?
Yeah.
You know they stole that from you. I mean, you originated that with the stealing of the Gary puppet. When you guys
You know, I don't know about that. I don't even want to know about it. I'm one lawsuit at a time.
You certainly didn't invent Shannon Doherty.
Yeah, we didn't invent Shannon Doherty.
You're not taking credit for that?
No.
You should.
Wait.
The First Amendment seems to only apply to people that are pro-war in this country.
I'm not missing the point.
She is missing the point. The point is that now that we have our troops over there fighting...
Just shut your mouth
now. These guys are going to get demoralized. Do you want Iraq to win now that we're doing this?
It sounds it.
The people who speak out against the war are being, the dissent is being criminalized. And that is not a democracy. So what we're supposed to be fighting for there is being Dixie Chicks albums being burned, people being blacklisted if that's happening, them getting lambasted by Fox News and the New York Post, stuff like that. That is not democracy. That is not protection of the First Amendment. And that is not American.
If free speech has been criminalized, name one person who's in jail right now for speaking out against the war. That is a crime. That's embarrassingly just ridiculous.
That is not true. Criminalized does not mean you have to be thrown in jail.
Criminalized means it's a crime. Words have consequences.
But people are getting fired. People are getting fired for speaking out against the war.
Who?
Yeah, who got fired?
Arnett, but that's because he was...
Arnett was on Iraqi television.
He's a newsman who's supposed to be objective while reporting events.
And then she said people are being blacklisted if that's happening.
Yeah, and
it's not happening.
It's being criminalized, but nobody's going to jail.
Where has anyone been blacklisted?
Yeah.
And I mean, if people want to burn Dixie Chicks' album, that's their right.
Right. People are pissed.
And she said it was an unprovoked attack. No, it wasn't.
Preemptive strike.
Yeah.
It was provoked.
We're supposed to send them a letter saying we're going to attack you on this day.
Wow.
Did you see Martin Sheen at this protest the other day?
With that piece of tape on his mouth?
What is that about? What is that supposed to say?
It's probably somebody went over there and taped his mouth shut.
It's the best I've heard him in years.
Yeah, it's...
He's carrying a crucifix.
I don't know. It just seems to me we haven't learned that... Once you commit, these soldiers into there, let them fight and be behind them. I mean... Unless you want Iraq to win, I mean, you got to make a decision who you want to win.
I remember you said it right after September 11th. You said, these people, we're just wait till we get crop dusted, and then they'll be ready for it.
Yeah, we need another, unfortunately, we need another sort of major catastrophe for these guys to do to us so people can get fired up again. I think every major catastrophe allows us to take over a country. Yeah. After 9/11, we were only allowed to do Afghanistan.
Right.
So people don't like that we're now going after Iran. Let me tell you something. There's an article in the paper today.
Yeah.
President Bush is now taking a very hard look at Iran.
And Syria.
Yeah, because he feels Iran is on the brink of nuclear weapon, having, again, weapons of mass destruction, as they call it. And he is saying, I think we might have to go in there next.
I was very happy to hear that over the weekend. I said, you know what? Then he's going to do what I think should be done. You can't have nutcases with nuclear weapons.
Right. He's going to go country by country and stormtroop through all of them. And
I don't care what
applaud the guy.
Janine Garofalo says. No. He doesn't get scared when crazy people have nukes.
Well, she doesn't get scared of anything because she lives in Los Angeles and has a completely pampered life.
That's right.
She's never experienced... horror. She hasn't. I guarantee you, she's never experienced the horror of warfare or what's done in a totalitarian country. She doesn't know. She's completely sheltered. She doesn't know.
How many independent films do you think she'd be doing in Iraq right now?
Oh, probably a lot. They love her there.
Yeah.
She's a big star.
She's going to be the biggest star in Iraq.
Mm. Hey, Paul, you're on the air. Oh, Paul's not there. Go ahead, Anthony.
Hey, I don't know if you guys caught the Yankee game last night, but in the seventh inning, after they had sung God Bless America, some of them Canadians were booing.
I didn't see it. Is that true?
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah.
Did you hear them booing?
I did, yeah. I was watching the game.
It was one of the most disgusting things I have ever witnessed, heard, watched. Terrible. We should yank that team right out of that country.
You're not kidding. And Canadians had me thrown off the radio in Toronto. The Canadian government had me thrown off the radio in Toronto and in Montreal. Because they couldn't. You know what it was? It wasn't that I was outrageous. It was that I was American. I know that's the case. Because now they're all getting a bunch of guys in there that can cop my act. They just didn't like an American making money in Canada.
Oh, absolutely. That was all it was about.
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, they watch all our television shows. I mean, but they were going
to
single me out.
They haven't figured out how to stop that.
And Canadians loved our show. We had huge ratings. There's no clear reason why other than I was American.
They've had a lock on radio the entire time radio's been invented. You know, they do that whole thing with you can only play a certain amount of American artists. You have to play mostly Canadian.
Yeah, Canada sucks.
Well, you know, all of the Blue Jays...
What are they doing, man? I mean, you know, rise up against your government.
All of the Blue Jays are American.
Yeah, don't start booing us. We protect you, you asses.
They're hypocrites.
I wish... push someone 9/11 them and see what they, if they like it. And we'll see. We'll see. They'll come to us. Oh, please help us.
That's right.
Oh, hoorah, Howard. You said it.
Bastards. Bastards.
You said it.
Sons of bitches. God damn it.
I'm doing the my nigga.
Sons of bitches.
Sons of bitches.
They're out to get us. Get them.
Get them.
Just repeat everything I say.
Robin does that good. That was eerie.
Hey, Joel, what's happening, brother?
Hey, the show's getting a little too serious. I was wondering if you could call Casey a faggot or... pick on Baba Booey's lips for a couple minutes.
All right, you're right. You know, I agree with you. But you, I don't know, do you ignore the war or do you... I mean, you've got to talk a little bit about it. It'd be kind of weird not to. If you're on the air, you're breaking up all over the place. It's like you're calling from Guam.
Howard, I'm calling from Canada, not far from Guam.
Yeah.
Listen, I just want to say on behalf of myself and a whole bunch of other Canadians, we're absolutely outraged with the reaction of the Canadian government. It's weak. And I'm embarrassed, and I got to tell you, I do a lot of business in the States, and I've been apologizing left, right, and center for the stand of the Canadian government. So, Howard, you got to know there are a lot of Canadians who are outraged at the fact the Canadian government is sitting on its hands.
I'm glad you called in. That's true.
We may have to come liberate you.
I might have to liberate you. I might be marching in with Robin.
I'm waiting to be liberated.
It's probably French-Canadians anyway.
Yeah.
Well, they've got you off the air in Quebec, but in Toronto, we can still listen to you on 92.9 Buffalo.
Good. That's
so
good news.
I'm a big fan, Howard. I love you.
Thank you. Yeah, we are quite popular in Canada still through Radio Free Buffalo. Brent, you're on the air.
Howard.
Hey.
Wow. Unbelievable talk to another Canadian, but I'm calling from Vancouver. Enough Americans yapping at us Canadians about this. We don't make the decision that Chrétien stepped out.
No, just shut your mouths, though, and don't boo our national anthem or any of our patriotic songs. Just shut up, because you know without us you're dead meat.
Do you know how long? Do you know how many guys are actually doing that? Such a small number.
I don't care. I don't want to hear it.
What can we do? Just you know.
Tell them to shut up when you see that happening. You just tell them to shut their mouths.
Duct tape over their mouth.
Yeah, like we do to Martin Sheen in our country.
But
Martin Sheen, we put duct tape over the guy's mouth.
Right, but don't forget what we did: World War II, World War I, Korea.
Yeah, we know what you did, but let's face it: we did all the hard work.
We did the heavy lifting.
Hey, come on.
Let's be real. Keep it real, buddy.
We are. But just you know,
with
the bad mouth and bud.
All right, thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right, well, who cares? Cares about any of this? Leave me alone. Why me? Stoner, you're on the air.
Hey, man, back when you had the TV show on CBS, I used to totally dig on the animation and the cartoons, man. That stuff was genius.
Yeah, that was some cool stuff.
Right, you know, like all the Baba Booey Missing Link Monkey Man cartoons?
Yeah, well...
And you mix animation with phone calls and radio content. And, Howard, you even did a cartoon video for the Backside Boys, right?
Yes.
Man, if you made a cartoon video to go with 50 Ways to Kill Saddam, that would be gnarly.
You're not for real, are you?
What do you mean?
I mean, with the whole...
Gnarly
and...
I'm out in California, man.
Dude, that's all over.
Well, I am what I am, and that's all what I am.
All right, whatever. You and David Lee Roth.
You know that rat Asian playmate chick, Aiko Tanaka, you had on yesterday?
Yeah?
I'd like to bang her on a sofa king. I'd bang her like crazy.
On a sofa king. Everybody loves that bit, sofa king.
Yeah, we might have to play that commercial again. I've hardly ever seen a commercial requested.
I might have to do a twofer, 50 Ways to Kill Saddam.
Have a good one, man.
I might have to do 50 Ways to Kill Saddam and Sofa King back to back. People like this song. Maybe we will animate it on
air. Yeah, that's a good idea.
I'd like to take Saddam and skull fuck his friggin' head. Bite off his worthless balls until the creeper's dead. Fuck him with a bayonet until he's ripped to shreds. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. I'd like to crazy glue his sphincter to the floor. Light the room on fire and then close the friggin' door. We'll gang rape both your sons 12 times and then we'll rape you like a whore. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. Let's kill Saddam and his mom.
Break his arms with a crowbar, Lars. Rape his ass with a broken glass, Chas. Sandpaper off his hip, Chip. And rub bleach in his wounds. Pour acid in his colon, Roland. Use his skull and go bowling. Put anthrax in his crack, Max. And let dogs eat his spleen. This Iraqi piece of shit ain't worth an ounce of piss. Do us all a favor, pal, and slit your stupid wrists. Let's spread open your butts and let you ride my greasy fist. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. And while we're at it, send Tim Robbins to Iraq. Along with Susan Sarandon, and hope they don't come back. If you two hate America, just leave and don't come back. Unless you help us kill that jerk Saddam. Kill Saddam and his mom. Rip off his pulse-eye cap. Bash in his head, Ted. Poke out his eyes, guys. And feed them to a pig. Shock his nuts with a stun gun. God damn it, would be such fun. Tear his c*** out of his jock, doc. Let's kill this Iraqi queen.
Wow. Imagine that animated. Especially that last line. Me pulling down his jock and ripping out his...
I was wondering, how do you animate some of that? I mean, you have to censor your cartoon.
Well, so you put a little bar over some of the animated weird stuff.
I think the skull effing could be done tastefully.
Right. You don't have to see the actual insertion.
Okay.
Right. There's a whole bunch of songs. There's only one other dude beside me who wrote a patriotic song. That was that country dude. Wait, you got that song? We never actually heard it.
I know. He just started twanging away and we ripped it right off.
Yeah, it was hard to get past the twang. Hey, you got that, Gary? No, here it is.
Ba-ba-ba-ba-boy!
Take it out of CD1. Throw that in. We want. Is it track one? It's the only one. What's the guy's name? Daryl Worley. He's supposed to be a big deal, right?
I wouldn't know. Oh. That name has never reached the level where I'd hear it.
Yeah, you know him. He's the guy who sang "The House Next to Me."
Oh,
the only thing I know him for is this.
For this, Daryl Worley. Did President Bush have him come to the White House?
I heard he played it for Bush. I don't know where it was. He
played it for Bush. See, this guy's real direct, you know? He lets you, he's not, like, you know, masking his feelings.
Right. You can tell exactly where he stands.
Yeah, he's not afraid to make a patriotic song. I dig this dude, Daryl Worley.
It's almost as good as 50 Ways to Kill Saddam.
It's almost. Mine's a little more direct.
Well, yours...
Mine's like, here's specifically what you can do to him.
Right. There's no hard time interpreting your song.
Yeah. So anyway...
I'm buying that today, by the way. That
yeah, that's a good song.
Daryl Worley, Have You Forgotten?
God bless you, Daryl.
Yeah. Keep singing, buddy.
Tape it up, you.
We should have him on the show.
We should. That'd be a first.
But then we'd have to sit through the whole song. Can we do it? Can we tell him to sing a little portion of it?
Just the chorus.
Yeah.
Have you forgotten?
I wish he could have rocked it a little.
Yeah.
Here's the other song.
Every country around the world has their own national song,
which is
their symbol of what their nation stands for. Our Star Spangled Banner, which is the title we use,
this creepish
national anthem, is just like saying Old Glory.
It's also exercising his freedom.
Didn't he sing for Bush? Mark Harris? Never. Never again.
My patriotic privilege for me to sing.
What happened to this guy? I mean, something.
I just think he was born in this
country. Really? I think something traumatic must have happened.
Can you see
early, early light?
What so proudly we hail at a twilight blessing, whose broad stripes and
on the air.
Hey, good morning, Howard. There are two female POWs. There was one black woman captured maybe about two or three weeks ago, but I haven't heard very much about her. And then recently I've been hearing about the one that was captured and rescued. Can you check that out for me? Why did I...
The other woman is captured. They don't have her. She was not rescued. She and a few others are still POWs.
They're probably being raped or...
Yeah. Could you imagine? I mean, that girl had two broken legs and a broken arm. Imagine what they did to her.
Yeah.
Probably never know what they did to her.
It sucks. So we still have women POWs that are over there.
Oh, yeah. And women are, you know, forget this. We don't allow women in combat. They're going to wind up in combat.
Yeah. Right.
Even if they're only working on, you know, the supply truck, they can be captured.
Yeah, well, go figure. Everybody else that they found at that hospital was dead.
I know.
Except for her.
I know.
So can you imagine what they were doing to her?
But my point is, you know, we're always saying we don't have women in combat. We do.
Randy, you're on the air.
Hey, I just wanted to correct Ronnie and say that what most cab drivers do from the Arab countries is they carry around a plastic bottle and they pee in the cab.
How do you know?
Many cab drivers have told me this, and you can smell it. You can smell it in the cabs. They call it going Arab. There's a term for it, going Arab.
Well, hey, let's not get into Arab bashing. We were trying to dehumanize Iraqis.
They call it going Iraqi.
Going Iraqi.
They'll call it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's right.
Why don't we have a contest? Whoever can come up with the best slur for an Iraqi.
Yeah, we need a name for Iraqis. What's going on?
That's specifically Iraqi, not like, just that part of the world.
A Saddam head.
Nah, you need something that, like, gook was great.
Right, we need their gook.
I see some Chinese people walking around, if you call them a gook, they dehumanize them right away. They wince.
Right, right.
You need something good.
Well, there's a name for them.
How do you make an Iraqi wince?
There's a name for them. They use the N-word as part of it.
Oh, a sand nigger.
Yeah. Nobody. Yeah. So
but that's,
we're looking specifically for Iraqi.
Right. That's the whole area there. We
need Iraqi terminology. Yes,
not
John.
Not just towel head. Not just.
Right, Robin. Not just that.
John, go ahead.
I'll work on that.
John, you're on the air.
Yeah, I want to. Ronnie's a complete and utter freak. He has no idea what the hell he's talking about. You want to talk about animals? Talk about freaking African Americans and the whites. Most Middle Easterns don't cause any crime. There's maybe there's a few stereotype of the, you know, of the actual people that actually did this bombing. Half these Middle Easterns want to have a better life for themselves. They go have better jobs. Most of them are in the medical field. They're not divorced like half these freaking white bastards. They don't have freaking kids who are like single stepmothers.
Dude, you're not helping. We have to dehumanize the enemy. What are you doing?
Guy's angry, man. He's worse than me.
This is the sick part about it. Who causes half the freaking crime in this world? Freaking blacks and whites. I would rather live with Asians than freaking Middle Eastern.
Get out of here with that, man. You can't say blacks and whites.
You're the biggest idiot. Look at the freaking youth. What, the 10% that freaking causes the crime, the 10% that are freaking maybe, you know, the bombers.
Everybody causes crime.
You're stupid.
You're an idiot.
It's not the kind of crime that takes
half the Middle Easterns get robbed. You know, they work
in Saddam kills his own people.
Who robs them? The freaking blacks rob them. Who makes fun of half these Middle Easterns? It's these whites and these freaking blacks. We don't cause any crime. It's that stupid 10% that's...
See why you can't dehumanize the enemy? Everyone's got a good point.
Hey, dude, are you Iraqi?
No, I'm Middle Eastern. I was born in Kuwait. I go to freaking medical school. Are you freaking out of your mind? I try to make a better life for myself. My parents had nothing. They have to freaking work their ass off. They put me through freaking college. They put me through a better life. I see half my friends are white. They have the worst life ever.
You disgraceful man.
You
use the S word.
Animal.
S word. Yeah.
Person on the air.
Animal. Cursing on the air.
How did you leak on the street, sir?
Hey, Aya.
Hey, Odd.
What's
up? Hey, now. Howard. I'm an Iraqi-American journalist writer, and I've done a lot of research, a lot of talking with a lot of people, and those guys, those POWs that they showed on the TV, those guys were tortured and sexually abused.
The men.
The men, I'm sure they're doing it to the women, too, because the first thing they do when they get an Iraqi prisoner is they strip them and they sexually abuse them to humiliate them.
Man or woman, they don't even care.
Oh yeah, and everybody. I mean, you know, of course, you've known about the stories where they rape the kids in front of their parents. But what they do with every person is they strip them first, and they sexually abuse them using electric shocks, broken bottles, you name is. And the pictures that we saw of the POWs and the guys executed, they were stripped, and you could see the torture marks on their bodies. So they definitely did all this stuff to them. And you know, the same with the women and everything.
So what's
I know when I was looking at the video of the POWs, the looks on their faces tell you they are scared to death.
Well, this guy's a journalist. Maybe he can think of a good
name. What I'm saying. What's a good slur word to call Iraqis during this war?
In Arabic or no?
give me a terminology that would really piss them off.
Oh.
Like, you know how, like, in Vietnam they had slow pads and gooks?
Yeah, but in Arabic you call them menayik, which is like, you know, which is homos.
So we should call them a homo?
Homos is what we should call them.
Let's call them homos. That's a good one.
I mean, Arabic. I don't know what they would get. So I'll tell you what, Howard, your
Thank
song,
you.
50 Ways to Kill Saddam, you should drop, Iraqis would love that song. They should drop it with a leaflet.
How about sand homos?
Sand homos, yeah.
How can I distinguish them from other homos?
I don't know.
Yeah, because homos shouldn't be disparaged.
You sandy homo?
We don't want to come out with anti-Arabs. I mean, we're not against Arabs, but we're fighting the Iraqis. We got to get a sand homos.
Sand my naiks.
Thank you. Sand my naiks. You sand my naik.
Hey, my naik, get out of the street.
Thank you, sir.
You're great.
It's a tough war to fight when you don't have a slur.
When you don't have a good name for that.
Even a slur. I mean,
I like sand homo. I do.
Sand homos.
I don't want to be a sand homo. You sand homo.
Come here, sand homo. You sand retard.
Come here, sand homo.
What are you, a sand homo?
I'd like to take Saddam and skull fuck his friggin' head. Fight off his whippers balls until the creeper's dead. Fuck him with a bayonet until he's ripped to shreds. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. I'd like to crazy glue his sphincter to the floor. Light the room on fire and then close the friggin' door. We'll gang rape both your sons 12 times and then we'll rape you like a whore. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. Let's kill Saddam and his mom. Break his arms with a crowbar, Lars. Rape his ass with a broken glass, Cash. Sandpaper off his hip, Chip. And rub bleach in his wounds. Pour acid in his colon, Roland. Use a skull and go bowling. Put anthrax in his crack, Max. And let dogs eat his spleen.
Just like Paul Simon.
This Iraqi piece of shit ain't worth an ounce of piss. Do us all a favor, pal, and slit your stupid wrists. Let's spread open your butts and let you ride my greasy fist. There must be 50 ways to kill Saddam. And while we're at it, send Tim Robbins to Iraq. Along with Susan Sarandon, and hope they don't come back. If you two hate America, just leave and don't come back unless you help us kill that jerk Saddam. Kill Saddam and his mom. Rip off his pulse, I cat. Bash in his head, Ted. Poke out his eyes, guys, and feed them to a pig. Shock his nuts with a stun gun. God damn it, would be such fun. Tear his f*** out of his jock, doc. Let's kill this Iraqi queen.
I was thinking, maybe I should go like on Letterman or Leno and perform this song.
Yeah,
I don't want to be interviewed. I just want to perform my new song.
Yeah.
Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah, he's probably the only one actually would entertain that.
You know what? I'm sitting here picturing bowling with Saddam's head. I love that.
You know, what about, I'm sure like Bill O'Reilly would let me sing
that. Oh, sure.
I need to go on a show.
You know,
to legitimize my song.
When I hear that, I wish my name was Roland so I could pour acid in his colon.
I just wanted to clear something up for that guy who called before and was so upset that he had a curse on the air. I mean, there's animals in every race. But we're just pointing it out now that the Iraqi, you know, the Iraqi animals, because of what's going on.
That's right.
There you go.
How about sand gooks?
Sand gook is, well, you know, it's a combination.
Let's go to Brian. Brian, you're on the air.
Hey, good morning, guys. Yeah, I was just saying, like, everything in that song, I mean, I love it. I'm a sick guy, too. But everything in that song is what you're saying that they're doing to our troops over there, bro. You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
So when you think about that, I mean, You know, that Howard, come on, you're a man. I'm a man, too, New Yorkers especially. You hear something like that happening to someone, man, you really, really want to kill somebody. You
right.
know what I'm saying?
Right.
And we ain't going to forget about what you did after the Twin Towers went. All the millions you did went directly to the thing. The people out here do love you, and we do listen to you. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you. I think
we should torture them like this. Don't take them to a chair. Make their toothpicks in their eyeballs and force them to watch Dirty Works on a loop. Ben Howard, have a good day, bro.
Billy, you're on the air.
Hey, what's up, Howard?
Wow. It's Dirty Work, not Works, by the way.
Yeah, Billy, go ahead.
Yeah, Howard, you know what you should call them? Little animals that they are, and they're annoying, and they think they got an army, but they really can't do nothing. Ewoks, those little annoying guys.
I like that.
Jedi.
Ewoks.
Hmm. Well, call them what, you know, his two sons, me and my friends call them. You ever see Saturday Night Live, the ambiguous gay duo?
Yeah.
Call his two sons, Ace and Gary.
Ace and Gary. Well.
Start spreading that around. They'll be getting all upset.
Ewok
is Ace and Gary?
Ewok is pretty good.
A Wookie. Call them the Wookiees, the Sand Wookiee.
I still like Sand Homos.
Well, Sand Homos is going to be a classic instantly.
Vin, go ahead.
Hi, Howard. I have a friend over in the Persian Gulf on the Iwo Jima. They've been calling them oil niggers over there.
What are they calling them?
Oil niggers.
Oil niggers.
Oil niggers. That's
sorry for the crappy phone, brother. I just wanted to call in. Thanks for everything. Right. You've been an inspiration to everyone.
But Sand Homos was a little more appropriate.
I like that, man. It's good.
How about oil homos?
Oil homos.
Oh, dear.
We need to get the N-word in there.
Petrol fags?
Petrol fags.
Something like that. All right, where was I? All right, thank you, Ronnie. Ronnie with his homespun logic, and he's our man on the street. He's out there every day.
He's our man on the front line.
Yeah, he sees it all.
Of the traffic wars.
So instead of Iraqis, it's Ewokis.
That's pretty good.
Okay. Hey,
that's a little too cute.
Yeah, Rocky. Makes him a little bit lovable.
Yeah.
Like, Gook is so perfect because it's to the point. It's right. One syllable.
All the way, they were really vicious, you know, crouch,
yeah.
Slope head.
Sand Gook
is sort of, you know, because we're going to have to fight the Koreans eventually. We need Gook to stay in
there. Yeah, we need Gook. We need Gook for the Koreans. And we need a special name for the Iraqis as opposed to the Iranis who are probably next.
Right. So we have to have a name for everybody.
Yeah, I'd like to.
Let me work on it. That's my job. President Bush has asked me to come up with a name.
Howard Stern is personally thinking up racial slurs.
He's the Secretary of Slurs.
I can see that Bush speech now. You know, we've got our Secretary of Home Defense, a great governor, Pennsylvania.
Tom Reed.
Our troops are progressing to Baghdad. Faster than we ever thought. And just yesterday, Howard Stern announced he's going to help us out and get on the bandwagon and come up with a really awful name for Iraqis. You know? And so far we got sand homos, goat rapers.
The finalists are.
And Howard Stern's going to be appointed any day now Secretary of Derogatory Names as soon as Congress approves his appointment. It's going to be something else. And every Akhnaat over there is gonna have a name.
We've located four new races in the West Indies. And Howard's gonna work on them.
Yeah, we're thinking of going to war with the West Indies. Howard's coming up with all kind of great names for all these different enemies of our country. So good night.
We'll be able to go in with a rallying cry using the name created by Howard Stern.
He's not only gonna come up with a name but a slogan.
Just think when your soldiers can yell out, get those sand homos.
Howard Stern already came up with 50 ways to kill Saddam. Everyone loves it.
The troops play this as they march into Baghdad.
What show could I get booked onto with my band?
Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah, that for sure.
Not big enough. Nobody even. I asked my kid the other day, because she stays up and watches Letterman and stuff. I said, you ever watch Kimmel? She goes, who?
She doesn't even know he's on.
Yeah.
Do you think Letterman would let you do it, or do you think it's too much for him?
I need a big forum.
The View.
You could be,
the
View. You could be on the results show of American Idol.
And I would love it.
You sing it with the kids.
I would love that.
The perfect place is Caroline Ray.
Wait a second. American Idol singing it with those kids?
That's a great idea.
Howard, you know what I see you doing there? You take them into the studio. They put one headphone on one ear. You record them.
Yeah.
And it's like a hymn.
And then if they have extra time at the end of the live show, I come out back out and do it again.
Yeah, you do it live with the kids, and I have dance numbers.
Yeah.
It's choreographed.
What's with that guy, Clay?
Oh, boy.
Dude, when they announced that, you know, what's going to happen with him, he tilts his head and bats his eyelashes like better than any chick I've ever seen.
I know. He might have a real...
A little expensive.
No, it's true.
Eric, you're on the air.
Hey, Stern.
Hey, Eric.
You really sound like a moron. You're embarrassing yourself completely. And Artie and...
You know who this is? One of the Jesus twins.
Oh, it is?
So he's great. Which one are you? The one who was in the insane asylum or the other one?
You really didn't because you know nothing about the war. I mean, first of all, you know everything.
Oh, it's the nut job.
First of all, Stern.
What medications are you on before you give us your tirade?
Let me tell you one thing. Artie, Robin, and you know nothing about politics and nothing about the war. First of all, Saudi Arabia and not Iraq was responsible for the 9/11 terrorists.
So how do you know that?
Because I've taken political science classes for
where?
Last few
where
years.
Did you take a political science class?
What?
Where did you take a political science class?
At the Valley College.
Valley College. Well, they have a direct line to the CIA.
I'm a nut, but you came up here and physically threatened people like Melrose Larry Green, who didn't even bother you. Who's a wacko? You didn't go. You went to Wacko University.
I'm sure he's been out with the peace protesters, and he's actually tried to harm people.
Well, you know they have a song. The Jesus Twins have a peace song.
Oh, really?
What is it? You guys did it to an old song. What is it again?
Peaceistheword.com.
Oh, right. Instead of Greece is the word.
What do you mean, peace is
the word? Let me ask you a question.
Peace is the word, is the word, is the word.
That's good.
Oh, dude, I'd have to Ritalin if I were you.
Let me ask you a question.
Okay, here's a good song. I'm cuckoo for peace.
Why is right now... This is an illegal war, first of all.
No, it's not.
Article 51 of the United Nations Charter only allows for a nation to use force in self-defense.
No, you're allowed to use force to enforce...
Our own U.S. Constitution.
We're allowed to use force when we're under attack. We're allowed to use force when people don't disarm.
We're not under attack. This is a preemptive strike.
No. We're at a war of terrorism. We went to war over 9/11 when we were attacked. We've identified Al-Qaeda cells.
How come we didn't catch Osama bin Laden? What, do we go after the first Arab?
Why don't you go catch him? Why don't you catch him?
And you schmuck saying that all Arabs look alike. That's like saying, all Chinese and all Filipinos.
No schmuck said anything like that.
Oh, please.
We don't think all Arabs look alike. We're talking about Iraqis.
Well,
and we're talking about the enemy.
Well,
and we're talking about, and you know what? I only wish you'd go over there and fight, because you know what? If you were over there hearing guys like you, you'd be demoralized fighting.
Let me tell you something. This attack was the worst thing that this country could have done.
What do you know? You're insane. You're an insane man.
Do you still trust what your brain says after it's done to you what it's done?
Tell people your personal history, and then we'll know whether or not you make sense. How could you even...
Let me tell you one thing.
And by the way, the Iraqis, if they capture you, would rape your little midget ass in 2 seconds.
Russia could claim the right to invade Israel now. France could claim the right to invade Turkey. And Great Britain could claim the right to invade Morocco. A preemptive strike, not since... Nazi Germany has preemption in use as an excuse.
You're in a disgrace.
That was conquering, you dope.
Hitler claimed aggression was necessary to prevent...
We're not going in there to occupy these lands. We're in there to liberate them. It's a big difference. We're not going to run it.
The war is about two things.
I know. Oil. You're a genius.
Destroying the petroleum in the area.
Yeah.
And to help out Israel.
All right. You know what? I hope the next terrorist attack occurs at your house where they blow your ass up. And then we'll see if you're laughing.
Let me ask you a question. Do you believe in the Constitution of the United States?
Yes.
Okay, then why does Article 6 of the U.S. Constitution make clear that international treaties like the U.N. Charter...
Let me ask you something.
Don't you remember a little revolution...
How old are you?
...that said Saddam was supposed
Wait
to disarm...
How old are you?
28.
All right. You're 28 and you're going to college?
I took a few political classes.
All right, listen to me. I'm going to tell you something. You're spending a lot of time at home being angry.
I'm not angry, dude.
In and out of mental institutions.
I'm not angry.
Let me tell you something.
The war.
What you need to do is get a suit Go to work every day and start earning some money and stop running around.
Look what a great country this is. He doesn't have to work.
Yeah, this guy hasn't worked. Since I know him, he hasn't worked.
What are you talking about? I work all the time.
Where do you go?
Where do you work?
I work every day.
Where
do you work?
I'm in the music business.
So you play songs in your head every day. That's what you do, right?
How do you make money at that?
How do I make money?
Nobody's buying it.
Yeah, well, when you put your guitar case open on the street, they throw money in it.
Right.
I mean, what are you doing to make money? I mean, listen to me. You got your views and everything, cool. But really, it's time to get the life together. You're 28 years old and you haven't had a job yet.
Let me tell you something.
Let's get to you. Forget Iraq. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong about Iraq, okay? And maybe you're right. But now, with all your knowledge.
Right. I just think that when you're lumping all Arabs.
We're not lumping all Arabs. You don't listen clearly because you have voices in your head. You're competing.
In my head. Okay, listen. What I'm saying is this.
You have a rich father. I don't have a rich father.
All Iraqi people. When the bottom line is, that's like everyone in every foreign country who hates Americans right now looking at every
We
American
know that. We're not saying that. We're not anti-Arab on the show. We're not.
There's 24 million Iraqi people. None of them are Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein's a scumbag. We all agree.
Look,
and he should be removed from power. But
to
sit here and malign innocent,
sand homos.
Innocent people, what?
Sand homos.
Okay.
That's who we're fighting.
Hook nose homos.
No, sand homos. That's who we're fighting. Go to work.
How about oil fruits?
Must be time for class. He heard a bell ring.
Yeah. Time to go to school at 28.
My poli sci class at Valley starting.
Time for class. The Valley School.
I was out with the Valley School over here.
By the way, these self-hating American teachers.
Oh, schools are some of the most vicious, awful places.
Are filling nut jobs like him up with this rhetoric.
Yeah, I tell you, your kid comes home from college, you won't even recognize their politics.
You should see my kid goes to college. I start talking about the war. You would think.
Most horrible race on earth.
You would think we were
Americans
terrible.
Americans are terrible.
They teach Americans to hate themselves.
They're being taught by hippies.
We're the best people there ever was. Americans. There's no better.
Yeah, a few years ago, before we had this going on, it was corporations they were against.
Right.
So your kid would come home a communist thinking that people shouldn't make money.
We're the best people.
And let me tell you something. When your kids go communist, it's another 5 years you got to support them.
That's right.
Yeah. Don't let them date a commie.
I tell you, Howard Stern's going to have to start going down to some of these colleges and talking to the kids himself.
The teachers, I don't know what happened to them, but, yeah, they're not very pro-American.
I'm so upset about this, I just refer to myself in third person, okay?
you heard that guy just said on the phone, he goes, Saddam Hussein's a scumbag, he should be removed from power.
Hey,
how does he plan on us doing that?
Listen
how is that going
to
happen?
To me,
we're
going to
vote
me.
Him out.
This guy, I love that guy. I'd have him on the show anytime. That's Eric from the Jesus Tree.
No, I know, but
all right?
I know
Stop
who he is, but... A lot of people...
I would actually like to hear that song. What is it? Peace is the word.
Hey, Gary, you got peace is the word before we go to commercial?
Not handy. We had it, but you hated it so much we threw it away. I get it again.
How can you get it?
I'll go to the website.
I want to play it now.
I'm saying, him aside, a lot of people against the war have that same view, that Saddam Hussein's got to be removed. How are we going to do that? He's not going anywhere.
Oh, they're stumped on that.
Yeah.
You want? I'm going to have to take a commercial break, and then I can play Pieces of the Word.
I got to hear it. It's time. It's time to break
All right.
Pieces of the Word.
We'll be back right after these words.
Who is Saddam Hussein? Who is Saddam Hussein? Who is Hussein? A maniac from Iraq who's raising Cain.
You're listening to the Howard Stern Show.
F you. All right, I got that song for you that you wanted.
Okay. F you.
Jesus Twins, peace is the word.
From this time forth, may all our thoughts, words, and deeds be a nonviolent resistance to all violence.
God didn't call America to do what she's doing in the world. God didn't call America to engage in a senseless, unjust war.
Fall back. Bring the troops home. No more war for oil.
I see the problems and I see the light. We gotta
What, the wah-wah pedal?
Yeah.
I love those guys. I can't be mad at them.
Yeah.
I like that he's in college.
Finally.
Yeah.
His parents have been trying to get him in for years.
Taking a political science class over at Valley College.
Yeah. Educating himself. For what we don't know.
Hey, Dale, you're on the air.
Yes, Howard.
Yeah.
How are you?
Hey.
Hey, just wanted to, I guess, make a comment on that piece is the word guy. First off, don't these people realize that if we weren't over there doing this so-called illegal war, that we would all be dead within 5 years if Saddam had his way?
Yeah, well, that's the whole point. No one's seeing that. It's this guy. This guy's getting himself armed to the nines. And going to come after us eventually.
Yeah, I mean, we should wait till he starts killing us.
Wait till he gets even stronger.
Yeah, yeah, and then go in and do something about it.
Yeah.
You know, but I just thought, you know, I think you're the greatest guy on the face of the earth there, Howard. I think you should run for office. I really do.
God help us all.
He may have to.
I might have to, though. I might have to. Dennis, you're on the air.
Howard, listen, I was in the Marine Corps, and when we used to go out into Saudi Arabia, a place like that in Iraq, we used to call them flags. They're Saddam loyalist fags.
Slags? That's a good word.
Slags. Yep.
Slags.
Yeah, we have to kill these slags. I like it.
Yep. It's a perfect name for them, you know?
Okay. I like it. Thank you. Slags. I like it. That's disgusting. You know, you're a slag.
Sounds like something you spit up.
Slow-mo.
I just killed four slags. Four slow-mos. No, slag.
Come here, slag.
Flag is like gook or,
yeah,
you know, slope head or
dip.
Nip.
Nip's a good one.
Or kraut.
Yeah.
Slag.
You know, get slag.
Hey, I'm going to call President Bush with that. He's waiting for me. All right, we heard enough of peace is the word?
Yeah, I wonder what the chorus sounds like.
Oh, forget it.
Yeah.
Eric's back on the phone. Yes, Eric.
Hey, play the rest of the song. You might learn something.
Oh, here he is.
The peace is the word.
If we ever learn something from you, we're in committing ourselves.
Seriously, Eric, you got to get back. You got to get into some kind of career.
Dude, my career is going great.
What is your career?
I'm a musician.
Nah, come on. Where are you playing? Where are you making money?
I just sold 4 songs publishing.
To who?
That's none of your business.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what it is you're up to, dude. I heard your dad was rich, and he supports you.
My dad is far from rich.
Really?
Not anymore since he supported
you. Yeah, exactly. He paid for the poli-sci class at Valley.
Classes are $10. I don't think they cost that much.
Teachers are good at Valley?
Stern.
Have you ever heard the concept, you get what you pay for? $10 a class.
Well, most universities are anti-American.
Yeah.
I'm not anti-American at all.
I'm sure you are.
How come you don't listen to people that know what they're talking about?
I'm listening
like,
to you.
Like Ritter, the guy who was the chief weapons inspector back in 91, who says, quote, that the truth is Iraq is not a threat to its neighbors and is not acting in a manner which threatens anyone.
Look, I'm not going to debate with you, but I'll tell you what. You're wrong and he's wrong because they invaded Kuwait. And if it wasn't for us, Kuwait would now be occupied by Iraq.
And who do you think financed that? The same
thing. You hear this? This is so silly. Hey, listen, Eric, I'm not a political show. Go call Rush Limbaugh.
Fine. Why don't you play the rest of the song so the people, there's a lot of people in this country that don't agree with this administration.
I'm going to play you a song. Where's my Metallica song?
Are they all like you? It's okay.
By the way, Ritter, just because I want to school you a little bit, Ritter was financed by Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Ritter was financed
you know that.
By Iraq.
Yeah.
And who do you think financed Hussein and gave him $500 million the same year that he...
Because we have a crystal ball and we're supposed to know who's going to be good or bad. Get out of here. Go help the slags. Nerd. Help the slags.
You slag lover?
Slag lover.
Bridge.
Slag lover.
Artie, your nose is so... You're far up.
Slag
down.
Lover. Slag lover.
Slag lover.
If Howard changed his position and was against the war, you guys would all be like, oh, yeah, you're right. It's not
slag
it's not
lover.
Just war.
Better up Howard's butt than Saddam.
That's not true.
Yeah, slag.
I'm pro-war.
Slag lover.
Come on down here, little slag lover.
You guys are just dumb. That's the problem.
That's right.
And we're enjoying ourselves.
And we're here and you're listening to us.
What about you?
Hey, I'm rubber, you're glue, dude. Anything you say bounces right off you.
10 billion Iraqis are going to die via starvation.
Anything I say bounces off me.
You could care less about Iraqis. Stop that bull crap.
Yeah, you better start caring about what medication you're on.
Son, let me tell you something.
You don't know one Iraqi.
Half the country's on medication, including probably your ex-wife.
Now, my ex-wife isn't on medication.
All right, well, it was a pleasure talking to you. Hopefully you could learn something, educate yourself.
Thank
about,
you.
We're going to listen to your song.
What's really going on. Yeah. Unfortunately, you probably get your news sources from Fox.
No. I get it from Valley College. Thank you. Valley College. What a waste of time that is. Just
$10
go...
classes, boy.
Hey, yeah, it's $10 a class.
What a bargain.
Where is my song? You have it ready to go? Since when do you have it ready to go? That one guy put together that Metallica song.
That was great.
That was really good. I sure wouldn't mind them playing that song while we invade Iraq. Listen to this.
I really wouldn't.
A plane has crashed into the World Trade Center. The World Trade Center is on fire. I don't have any more details. Well, we finally have a president who fooled all these guys. Well, God bless this guy, because and you listen to that song, it reminds you what went on 9/11. And we were all fired up. We got to go get these guys. Well, now you got a guy, a president, who's willing to fight the good fight right now. Take care of the problem now. Nip it in the bud. He's nipping in the bud. This Saddam Hussein never expected this, never figured for this, when he was handing over billions to these terrorists to help, you know, mess with. The Americans, they don't do anything. Don't worry about it. They never expected it.
They never come after a country.
It was a nice little project they had going, blowing up little pieces of New York City, the Pentagon, seeing what they can get away with. They never expected that he would come in and root them out.
Yeah.
This is amazing what's going on.
They all listen to their movie stars over there. They won't do anything.
Yeah, they won't do anything. They're not going to go into Afghanistan. They're not going to invade Iraq when the rest of the world is against it.
Yes, yeah, Sean Penn said he wouldn't let them.
When Eric from the Jesus Twins is against it, they'll never do it. Never.
There are people in Valley College right now who will protect us.
All of the students there. God bless this President Bush and be behind
And everybody thinks this wasn't an easy decision for him, and it's not easy to go through it.
No. It could be political suicide, but so what? He's doing the right thing. And you got to get behind the dude, and you got to say they're doing the right thing. That's all. It's the bottom line. This is it. Payback time. Payback's a bitch. They never expected it. Who's next? I can't wait to see who he starts in with next. 9/11, we're all like, let's go over there and teach them a lesson. Now the lesson's being taught. You know, trust me, they are reeling. Do you know what this means? We're going to change a government over there. We've never done this before.
You know, France is now saying, yes, the Saddam regime must go. Yes, we do want to see that.
Yeah, well, yeah, Johnny come latelys.
The other countries.
Froggy come lately. Let me tell you something. This is a great message. Never before had we been attacked on our soil like this, where a building of the World Trade Center's magnitude was blown up, and now never before have we ever gone in and changed the regime. Payback's a bitch. They will never change it. They can't do it. The United Nations will protect us. They protect all our scumbags.
Well, I think we have gone in and changed regimes before.
No. They're saying without a... We're calling it a preemptive strike. We've never done this before. But we were not responsible. You can prove we were not responsible. But too bad. This is a new kind of war. This is where we figure you're up to something bad.
We're going to get paranoid like you are.
Yeah, we're paranoid. You make us uneasy. So you know what we're going to do? We're going to kill you.
You know, right now we're like a guy beating up a guy in a bar, looking at his friends, go, what are you looking at?
You have a mural of 9/11 in your bunker. It disturbs us.
You're going down.
You're upsetting us. And when you upset us, we kill you. And we change the regime. And if this next regime doesn't work out, we'll come in and kill them, too. We got to get crazy.
I've always said that. How do you deal with a crazy person? Get crazier.
Yeah. Embarrass them. Shame them. Teach them a lesson.
Knock him around.
Like a dog that's out of control.
We gotta get
that newspaper and hit him on the nose.
Yeah, obedience school.
We gotta get like crazy like Joe Pesci and Goodfellas.
Yeah, I tell you, people didn't mess with him.
Like after we shoot somebody, we gotta go. Well, you gotta get a problem with what I did, Anthony?
That's right. You gotta shoot a guy in the foot.
Huh?
And let's see if there's another terrorist attack. Let's pick another country. I don't think our president's done.
I don't think we should wait again. What is this waiting around for to happen?
I think we should start a new invasion today. Because they're slags.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, and let me tell you, the people of Iraq, there's a lot of good people in Iraq. They're going to be free.
We're going to find them.
Yeah. We're going to find them. Even if
right now, they're not visible.
Even if at the end of this, we're down to five people.
Wait, you see how great life could be, those people. Are you going to be in softball leagues?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You'll have
picnics.
A bowling night.
Because Tim Robbins is going to come over there and build baseball fields.
Yeah, Tim Robbins, pussy. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. I wasn't going to brag, but I was in the gym yesterday with Pat Menachia, pumping up in case I have to go over. Because who knows? Yeah. One day we might be called.
We might have to do hand in hand right now.
Look at me. I'm gorgeous.
You're pumping up in case you have to
are
do
you,
that song.
Have even, you lost the 15 pounds?
Not yet, but I'm in hair removal. They'll know it's me.
You never know when he might be called to L.A. to do that song on the Kimmel Show.
I was over getting my laser hair removed.
Again?
Sure. Got to go once a month.
You're going to look good in that uniform.
Goddamn right. I'm not going to disrespect the United States uniform with back hair.
How about that? That's what we're going to show the Iraqi people. Stuff like completely bare. You know?
A whole new market.
You're not going to believe this. You saw that terrorist dude they caught?
Yeah.
With the back hair?
Exactly.
You're not going to believe this. They could get rid of my hair.
I'm completely hair free.
I might lose weight now.
Under Saddam Hussein, he said there's no way to get rid of back hair. But now we go to completely bare with Howard Stern.
It's fantastic.
It's unbelievable.
More than a dozen Al-Qaeda operatives are hiding out in Mexico, desperately looking for a way to sneak over the border and carry out terrorist attacks on the United States, according
Who's doing
to new
that?
Reports. Al-Qaeda operatives. They're down in Mexico trying to get in. At least 14 members of the terrorist organization headed by Osama bin Laden are in Mexico and have sought the assistance of drug smuggling organized crime factions and others to try to sneak into the country.
Yeah, those guys don't want anything to do with that organized crime. They don't want any. They like the way things are.
I should hope.
They don't want to see terrorism. So silly.
But they're just, you know, they're knocking on every door seeing if they can get some help. Meanwhile, in Oakland, California, apparently California is a hotbed of dissidents. So they had more of these protesters at some area, a port, the port of Oakland yesterday. Listen to this, E2.
All right.
This is not Baghdad. This is Oakland.
What are you saying?
E2.
All right. All right.
They had to go in there. They started shooting blanks to disperse the crowd. About 700 people showed up before dawn to protest the war and block shipments from government contractors. Police in riot gear were captured on video firing wooden dowels and bean bags at the protesters as they walked away. The police said it was necessary. Most of the protesters were dispersed in an orderly manner. But then some of the protesters started lobbing things at the cops, and that kind of a melee broke out. Here are some of the protesters talking about what happened to them after showing off their deep welts and cuts. E3.
Hit the side of the nose, hit the back a bunch of times. It's bleeding a lot. I mean, I think I'm okay, but it's totally unprovoked.
This bullet was shot, I'm assuming, directly at me because it hit me in the head from the side. It did not come up. So I'm assuming that they were aiming right for my head.
Stop with the protests already. The war is already almost over.
Right.
Enough.
But
you get the
they're
point.
So happy with their war wounds.
You don't want to get hit, stay home.
Yeah, they're being hit with beanbags.
Beanbag pussies.
The Iraqi people would welcome a beanbag barrage.
Beanbags. Poor cops. Everything's gotten so politically corrupt. They got to hit people with beanbags. What's next? Pillow fights? God, back in the day when my uncle was a cop, he got to use real bullets, kill a few people. Now you got to shoot people with beanbags. What a bummer. Poor cops today. Hands are tied.
And
hold it. Cease, Robin, right now or I'll tickle you with this feather. So for anyone out there who was like, well, I guess President Bush lied to us. You know what? Yeah. He lied to us.
Because you need it.
You need to be lied to because you need a reason. The reason was 9/11.